The future is now for the Delaware Blue Hens as the 2016 football season opens tonight at Delaware Stadium. You're listening to 94.7 WDSD-FM. I'm Scott Fatskin in the Value Days broadcast booth presented by Shell alongside Matt Janis and on-site producer James Taylor. On the field handling sound is Mike Diodati, and on the sideline is former Blue Hen Michael Atanase. In a few minutes, University of Delaware will face Delaware State University for the seventh time in school history, but the in-state rivalry is secondary to the excitement and expectation surrounding this 2016 Blue Hen season.
Expectation is the name of the game this year for Delaware, Scotty. Their head coach came out early on and he set the tone. He said, we will be a postseason team. We have built this program through a recruiting trail. We are set. We are stacked at every position. We have the depth we were looking for. We have the athleticism we are looking for. Now it's all about going out and backing it up with their play, and they are looking to set the tone today against Delaware State. Dave Brock always says before the opener, it's about Delaware, it's not about the opponent. But tonight, that's more true than I can ever remember it. This coaching staff wasn't necessarily sure what to expect from the Hornets. There wasn't a lot of advanced scouting done of Delaware State because they have a new defensive coordinator. They've been talking all offseason about redoing their offense and rebuilding it from scratch. They have 43 newcomers that will play for the first time for Delaware State today. So there's a lot of uncertainty with the opponent, but the Hens feel very good about themselves. And, you know, if positive vibes were a direct link to success, then the Hens would already be in the postseason. It isn't. You have to back it up on the field. But I'll say this, it's awful refreshing talking to these players, talking to these coaching staff members, because they have a ton of confidence and they feel really good about their opportunity.
And they're playing, although an opponent that the players on the team might not be familiar, a somewhat familiar opponent, Delaware 6-0 all time against DSU. It all started back in the playoffs in 2007, most recently 2014, when Delaware won 27-9 on a Sunday. Today, we start things off on a Thursday, and Michael Atanase is on the field. It's a lot of excitement. How's the feeling down on the sideline, Mike?
Guys, one word, electric. These guys came out full sprint out of that Delaware helmet on the entrance. They are jumping up and down, banging helmets. The student section is filling up right now, looks almost packed. The home side is packed. It's going to be a great evening here in Newark, Delaware.
We look forward to it at Delaware Stadium, where Delaware will start things off in front of a packed student section. Delaware State will defer. They won the toss. University of Delaware will get the ball first, so we'll be able to see that offense. Let me get you the starters first. Brought to you by National 5-10 on Main Street in Newark. For Delaware on offense, the quarterback, Joe Walker, the red shirt sophomore. The running back is Wes Hills. Tight end is Owen Tyler. Three wide receivers, Jamie Jarman, Vinny Papali, and Deontay Cherry. The starting offensive lineman from left to right, Trump, Lewis, Kern, Farinella, and Bozick. We did get word today that Brandon Whaley, all-conference tight end, is not active. We don't know why, but he will not play in the season opener. On defense for the Hens, Nassib, Woodson, Nichols, Kitchen. That's the defensive line. The linebackers, Jackson Bell, and we'll see Troy Reeder for the first time. The corners, Justin Watson and Nasir Adderley. Ray Jones and Ryan Torza are the safeties. For DSU on offense, Daniel Epperson, the JUCO transfer, is the quarterback. Bryson Align is the running back. The tight end, Dominic Floyd. Three wide receivers, Rutherford, Scott, and Williams. The offensive line from left to right, Fala, Pedro Mangoni, an all-conference performer, Wallace and Borum. On the defensive side for DSU, the ends, Barrett and Nelson. The tackles, Alejo and Barnes. The linebackers, Cavacante and Malik Harrison, all MEAC performer a season ago when he had over 100 tackles. Denzel Burgett from Middletown is the third linebacker. The corners, William Burton, Gary Melton, and the safeties, Xavier Wilcher and Logan Westcott. The head coaching matchup, Dave Brock, in his fourth season, 17-18 as head coach of the Hens, trying to get his record to 500 with a win on opening night. Kenny Carter, in his first season a year ago with DSU, his team finished 1-10 on the year. He'll try to improve upon that in year number two as head coach of the Hornets. Hornets come out in the away white uniforms, white helmets for the first time in DSU history. New helmets that they're sporting this season as part of their new Nike contract that they have. The Hornet on the helmet and kind of a faded black and light blue numbers on the jersey, red stripes. They'll go left to right, kicking towards the student section. Delaware wearing the home blues with the yellow pants. And we are getting ready for kickoff. West Hills, Ray Jones are back to return for the Hens.
And this is one of the key points that you're already seeing. Jay Brock wanted to get more dynamic in the return game. West Hills returning to the lineup after missing almost a full calendar year. And it'd be nice to see him do something special to get it going.
So the ball is teed up. It's going to be Nzidi kicking things off for DSU. Wes Hills, good to see him back. We'll see if he gets a chance on the return. Ray Jones led the team in kick returns a season ago with 29. Ball's teed up, and the 2016 season is underway. Ray Jones with a foot in the end zone at the 5 to the 10, looking for space at the 15. Outside at the 20, towards the sideline at the 25-yard line. And out of bounds, here comes Joe Walker. And the offense, he was pushed out by Nyree Williamson.
Good job by Jamie Jarman on that return. Kind of lost his edge a little bit as Jones made a nice juke move to the outside. Jarman thought about kind of grabbing shoulder, grabbing cloth. You don't want to start the season with a hold. You've got decent field position. Nice return by Joe.
So Delaware will start actually at their own 26-yard line. Man, we've been waiting for this, haven't we?
It seems like it took forever that offseason to finally get here, but now a new era is Joe Walker poised and ready to go.
Single back is Wes Hills to start off. And the first play is a screen pass to Jamie Jarman. He's got blocking at the 30 to the 34-yard line. 8-yard pickup on first down. Pretty good for Joe Walker.
Yeah, that was really nice job. The quick throw in space, it does two things. A, it gets Joe Walker some early confidence with a completion, high percentage throw. B, getting the ball to Jarman in space to operate. That's something they were trying to do last season, just couldn't find a way to get it done. He can be electric in the open field.
Walker starts 1 of 1. You remember, 44% completion last year. You're right, Matt, get some confidence. Here's Wes Hills running strong to the right side and picks up the first down across the 35 to the 36-yard line. Malik Harris makes a tackle. He did that 104 times a season ago. First down of the day for Delaware.
Yeah, but he paid to make that tackle. Wes Hills lowered his shoulder, put it right into Harris's chest and ran right through him. It was a heck of a tackle by Harris to bring him down. And already we are seeing it being made clear by Delaware State. 8 guys packing the box. They're going to dare Delaware to throw the ball, but the Hens should still be able to run even with that packed box.
We see Jefferson in, split out as a wide receiver. Charles Scarf for the first time. Single back is Wes Hills. They'll go to Hills again. He gets the 40-yard line, running right, and the tackle made by Gary Melton from that secondary spot.
One of the things Dave Brock talked about late in the offseason was not losing their identity. So much work and so much attention spent in camp trying to get that passing game jump started. And he said, you know, we started to look good, but you have to remember who this team is still. It's a run-first team, ground and pound, win first down on the ground, set up second down and manageables. And Delaware is going to do a lot of first down running this year.
Second and 7 for Delaware. Ball on their own 40. 13-14. First quarter, first possession. Wes Hills is a single back. 2 wide receivers to left. Walker's 1 of 1. Going to throw, and he'll be 1 of 2. As that one seemed more of a miscommunication, he threw it ahead of Papali and well behind Jamie Jarman.
I think Jarman was supposed to run an out pattern that time, but I'm a little confused because Papali would have been too close in the vicinity. So I think that might have been a misread by Walker that time, or complete miscommunication from Papali and Jarman, because that was not an inaccurate throw. He tossed that, it seemed, right where he wanted it to go. The receiver just was not home.
Delaware has 3rd down and 7. Almost 2 minutes into the first quarter of action. Walker will go out a shotgun for the first time. To his right is Wes Hills. Cherry to his right, 2 wide receivers to his left. Blitz coming from the left side. Walker has time to throw, and he gets it to Scarf, who holds on in Delaware State territory for a first down. He crashed right into Logan Westcott, and the transfer from Rutgers moves his sticks 13 yards.
Tell you what, very impressive job there on the blitz pickup. First things first for Delaware. Gave Walker all kinds of time to scan the field. And there's a situation where he looked at multiple targets, found Scarf over the middle, and then a great hands catch by Scarf not to let that get in on the body, which was Delaware's bugaboo a year ago.
What a grab. I was going to say, we wouldn't have seen that catch in 2015. Hill still the single back, first and 10. At the DSU 48-yard line. And they'll go to Hills running left for the first time. And he gets to the 44-yard line of Delaware State. Brought down by Javon Barnes and company. There's not going to be an individual solo tackle on Wes Hills.
That's a great call, and it's going to be Delaware State's job today to flow to the football. They have got to over-pursue, and they've got to tackle with multiple bodies, and it's only a matter of time till the Hens will hit some kind of a comeback or a misdirection and take advantage of Delaware State needing to be overly aggressive.
First possession of the day, second and six, 44-yard line's the spot of the football in Del State territory. 11:57 first quarter. Walker back in shotgun form, and he's going to run the football to the 40-yard line, and he gets past a defender at the 30, 25, and down goes Joe Walker. They said they want to run the football a little bit more with Joe this season, give him the option to do so, and he picks up 18 on his first try.
Tell you what, if you're Joe Walker that time, that's a design run, and it's a nice move around the edge. Use the quickness to get to the outside, and then he still has that power, that strong lower body to run through a tackle. He just looks like a running back out there with the ball in his hands, but want to see him make sure he protects himself at the end of the play.
Ball's at the 25-yard line as Delaware works her way towards the north end zone. Under center again, it's a toss play to Wes Hills. Running to the right, hurdles a defender to the outside. 15, 10, 5, diving, touchdown! No, they're going to say he stepped out at the 4. He couldn't stay in bounds. He dove over the goal line, but it was after his foot touched the end line or the sideline at the 4. What an athlete Wes Hills is.
But what a move in the open field as he gets to the outside on Malik Harris. Delaware State's best defender put that foot in the turf and then cut back and just left Harris flailing at air. And that you see right there why Wes Hills is so special and how much he was missed a season ago.
First and goal to go from the 4. Under center is Joe Walker. Give is to Hills. He sheds one in the backfield. Gets back to line of scrimmage. Picks up 2. He's held up at the 2-yard line. It's second and goal to go.
Fifth time Wes Hills, I believe, has touched the football on this opening drive. And all but one of the occasions, he has made guys miss. And that time, it wasn't any type of a move. He just ran right through them. And that's the beauty of Hills. We talked about the different skill sets that these guys possess. But I'll tell you what, Wes Hills possesses all of the skill sets. He can run through you. He can run around you. He can make you miss.
They'll bring in Jalen Randolph. We'll see a two-back set. Walker under center, first and goal to go from the 2. Randolph and Hills behind him. They'll give it to Randolph, and Randolph finishes the drive. A touchdown for Delaware.
Well, Jalen Randolph understanding how to go downhill there, running low to the ground. Good lead block on the inside, and that's that multiple back set that we were talking about. You have to defend both sides of the field, and all of the backs can block for each other. That's the thing. Wes Hills did the heavy lifting on that drive, but you see him jump on top of Jalen Randolph inside the end zone. He's as happy as if he scored.
Frank Rago will try the extra point with 10:09 left in the first quarter. Holder is Stevenson, the new punter. Hold is down, kick is up. And Arango is through with 10:09 in the first quarter. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Blue Hens 7, Hornets nothing.
We brought you here today to get your honest opinion about this new car. To keep things unbiased, we removed all the logos.
Feels like a BMW.
Reminds me a little bit of an Audi.
So this car supports Apple CarPlay.
Siri, open maps. Wow. She gets me.
It also has teen driver technology. It even mutes the radio until the seatbelts are buckled.
I'm very curious what it is.
This is the 2016 Chevy Malibu.
And it sells for?
It starts at
$22,500. What?
Oh, wow. I mean, all this technology.
That's a game changer.
Little details. Truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, The future is now.
The future is now on 94.7 WDSD.
Plays 74 yards. Delaware goes up 7-0 on a touchdown run from 2 yards out from Jalen Randolph. A pretty complete drive by the hands and set it down to Mike at Rasa.
Guys, that's exactly what you want to see from your offense. They come on the field, they take the field first, and they just drive down the field and put it in. That was a complete drive. Like you said, Scott, we had the third down conversion. We saw passing from our quarterback. We saw a rush. We saw good running out of our two running backs and great blocking by the O-line. I couldn't say more about that drive.
And it's not balanced that Delaware needs offensively, Mike. What they need is the ability to be able to be productive on both ends of the game. You got to be able to run it. You got to be able to throw it a little bit. You're not looking for that 50-50 split. What you're looking for is the quarterback to be able to keep the offense on the field. Joe Walker was able to do that. He needs to be high percentage. He needs to protect the football, and he needs to keep them honest. And Delaware did precisely that on that opening drive with the two completions and both solid throws from Joe Walker.
Well, I was hoping we'd see Delaware either kick off first or score early, because Coach Brock has been really hyping up his kicker, Jake Roth, the walk-on from Reading, Pennsylvania. He says that this guy can really boot it. We'll see what he gets here, kicking it towards the north end zone. As DSU will get the football first, Bryson Aline is back to return for DSU with a heads up 7-0, and he boots that one. Returned by a line at the 3 to the 10-yard line, running left at the 15. Has a blocker at the 20 to the 25, 30. 40-yard line for a line, and he's brought down towards midfield by Ryan Torza. In fact, he was at midfield. We'll call it a 46-yard return. They'll mark it at the 49-yard line. That's the spark the DSU needs to start things off. Hey, Jalen Randolph just ran the ball into the end zone on the last possession. That dash into the end zone brought to you by Dash In. Nothing great was built on an empty stomach. Dash In now offers all new breakfast sandwiches on a warm buttery croissant roll. Try sausage, egg and cheese, bacon, egg and cheese, and double egg and cheese. Grab a 16-ounce Dash In coffee and breakfast sandwich for only $3.50.
And welcome to the season. Nasir Adderley, who got absolutely blown up by Mike Waters. That's what set up that hole on the return.
Daniel Epperson, the new quarterback for Delaware State, transfer from JUCO. He'll start in shotgun form with quads to the right side, and a pass is caught by a line low to go get it. And he is brought down right at the goal line. It's Charles Bellow at 96 tackles a season ago. He gets the first for the DSU, for the Delaware defense this year.
Yeah, you know, Charles Bellow, they always talk about how he's a downhill player. That was a downhill tackle to start the season defensively.
DSU going fast, quick snap, and a throw is intercepted. What a catch by the long arm, John Nassib, on the second defensive play of the season. Nassib takes it away.
What a play by Nassib, because it's the read. He engages the offensive lineman, then backs up into the passing lane. And Dave Brock talks about all the time how John Nassib does so many things that don't show up on a stat sheet, but they're monumental in a game. Well, that's going to show up on the stat sheet, and that's going to be on the highlight reel. That might end up being the best interception of the season. He tipped it with one hand, grabbed it with the other after he deflected it up in the air.
If an offensive player made that grab a season ago, it would have been the best catch that anyone made all season long. My goodness, John Nassib, younger brother of Ryan on the Giants, and Carl is now on the Browns with an interception. That was nothing short of spectacular. Delaware with the football again, 9:30, first quarter action, up 7-0. They'll start on the DSU 49, and the run is to Hills. He cuts it back at the line of scrimmage and picks up 11 on the first run of this possession. Tackle by Gary Melton.
Our old colleague Matt Ryan used to describe West Hills' running style as a baby deer. His legs just kind of flail about, and he somehow manages to keep his balance when you're not really sure why. He just changes direction so quickly, and he has great vision. One cut at the line of scrimmage, another cut back to the right once he got to the mid-level, and he gets a first down.
I form now for Delaware. Yoakum's back there with West Hills as they send a tight end in motion on first and 10 for the DSU 37. It's Hills lowering his shoulder and a DSU defender at the 32. a 5-yard gain that time, and the defender that took the hit was Xavier Wiltshire.
I love it. Run an H-back back there. Lead blocker. If you're going to run power stuff, and you're not going to be a monumental threat in terms of pushing the ball down the field, which at least at this juncture of the season, Delaware is not, why not put an extra body in there to move some guys out of the way? And Yoakum, pretty good block up front. It turns into a downhill run for Delaware.
Cherry split out to the left, 2nd and 5 for Delaware on the DSU 32-yard line, up 7-0. Randolph is in as a single back. Randolph's second carry, back to the line of scrimmage this time. He scored the touchdown on the opening drive. West Hills with 33 yards rushing on that opening drive, but it was Randolph who finished off the series with the touchdown. And the tackle made again by Javon Barnes.
Yeah, Barnes did a great job just to clog space and take care of two blockers. And I think that freed up Malik Harris to get in there, make first contact, and then Barnes shed those two blockers and got in on the tackle. That's a phenomenal play by the D tackle. That's his job, clog space in the middle.
Hens had a big third down conversion on that opening drive. 1 of 1, it was a catch by Charles Scarf. They need 5 to continue the drive this time around. Walker in shotgun, dumps it to Randolph. Randolph has a first down to the 25-yard line on the screen pass tackle made by Brian Cavalcante, but the Hens are 2 of 2 on third down.
That's just great execution. Delaware State saw a screen coming. They tried to react to it, but the Hens executed almost perfectly. A couple of nice cut blocks on the edge, offensive line out in front, and I think we're going to see the screen game implemented big time for Delaware this year. You couldn't use it too much last year because you just didn't have any type of threat on the outside, and there were too many bodies center the field. It's not going to be that way this season.
Randolph remains in. Yoakum, the H-back, stands behind Walker on 1st and 10 from the 25. It's Randolph. He gets contact at the 23, runs to the 20, and the Hens are in the red zone for the second time today. Tackle made up front by Dominique Drury with 6:52 remaining in the first quarter. Hens up 7-0.
Speaking of up front, they are whipping them up front right now. Jake Trump had a good block that time. Brody Kern, the push is there. It's against a loaded box, and you're still getting two or three free steps past the line of scrimmage by these running backs.
DSU stack in the box on 2nd and 5 from the 20. Scarf goes in motion from right to left. Walker will go to Randolph. A little pitter-patter looking for space patiently. And a tackle made by Atwater as Randolph got to the 18.
Well, you talk all the time about 8 guys in a box. Del State up the ante. They went 9 in the box that time. 9 guys within 6 yards of the line of scrimmage. Still a very good patient run by Jalen Randolph. They had a kamikaze run blitz up the middle. Randolph just kind of sidestepped the linebacker coming through and was able to turn what looked like was going to be a negative play into a small gain.
Hens third down, 3 yards to go. Walker in shotgun form this time, with Randolph the back to his left. 2 wide receivers to the far side right. Jarman on the near side. It's Walker, another designed run. And Walker, I believe, is going to be just shy of the 15-yard line where he needed to get to pick up the first.
That wasn't even a decision for Dave Brock. No one looked over. Everybody went right back to the huddle. They knew they were going for it. You're dominating the early stage of this football game. This is a statement, again, not so much about tonight, but about this football. You're going power on Del State's power, and you just want to win the war up front.
In front of a packed student section, you're going for it on 4th down, and the Hens are doing just that from the 16 of DSU, 4th and 1 yard. Under center is Walker. He'll keep it. 2nd effort gets him there, and the drive continues.
What a play by Joe Walker, Scott, because you had, again, the middle clog that time, a great push by Barnes yet again, and there was nowhere for Walker to lean. He spun off the contact and then backpedaled his way and just fell forward. Obviously, quarterback sneak's all about just finding a crack or a crevice to fall through, but normally you don't get that opportunity for the 2nd effort. That is a surprisingly athletic play on a QB sneak by Walker.
Now Walker under center on 1st and 10 from the DSU 14. Pitch play goes to Hills. He's got some speed. Cuts it at the 10. Dragging defenders inside the 5. And Delaware has a 1st down and goal to go from the 3.
I don't know how you could diagnose a much better start than this if you're Dave Brock. Maybe a deep ball hit down the middle from your passing attack, but you are dominating the line of scrimmage. You are running the ball with incredible precision and just grace from Wes Hills in the early going. Jalen Randolph's made a couple of guys miss, plus your defense already has a takeaway.
Hills will remain in with the football at the 3-yard line. First and goal to go. Hands up 7-0. Walker. Hills with the carry. Hills diving for it, and he's going to get stopped just inches shy of that goal line. It'll be second down and goal.
That play had nowhere to go. Del State diagnosed it. They flooded the outside. They set the edge. And Wes Hills, you're not supposed to leave your feet in near the goal line because that's where bad things can happen. But when you have guys at your feet, you're kind of left with little option. Wes Hills jumped from about the 4 and just levitated his way. Almost got all the way to the goal line inside the 1.
Walker will have Randolph and Hills again to choose from the far side hash. Second and goal to go, an inch away from another touchdown. Walker will keep it, Walker will score. It's 13-0 Blue Hens here in the first.
Joe Walker just piling over. And we talked about how, hey, that quarterback sneak was not there on the 4th-and-1. Walker had to make it happen. Well, the offensive line redeemed itself that time. 3 Delaware State defensive linemen knocked 3 yards back into the end zone. And Walker barely had to fall down. He could have gone in standing up on the sneak if he hadn't already known.
Frank Rago in for the second time in the first quarter of action. 3:20 left. He's got one extra point. Some movement before the snap. Flag thrown. Rago drilled it. Somebody's got to go get the ball, but he'll kick it again.
You know what, though? That actually might make Dave Brock happy. Sometimes you don't want it to be too perfect too early. A mistake. Something that he could go yell at somebody for.
He hasn't had too much to yell at thus far, that's for sure.
Before the snap. Offside defense. Half the distance to the goal, replay the try.
Or not. Del State making the mistake as they did the movement. They jumped into the neutral zone. That forced the center of the line to move. And I mean, it's only a half-yard penalty, but it's still a pretty clean slate for UD right now.
Raga will try again. That was practice.
Reset. Defense.
And he boots that one through as well. 14-0, that's your PNC Bank timeout score. Hens on top, 3:20, first quarter.
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any 2. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
Just tuning in, I want to watch this.
One Electronics for once again providing the WDSD broadcast equipment for UD football broadcasts. The team at BEL is busy with many jobs this time of year as school gets back in action, but still takes the time needed to make sure that our equipment is set up, checked, tested, and ready for kickoff. It's a lot of work to get ready for our first broadcast, and we wouldn't be set in time without Brandywine Electronics. It's the dedication and quality that makes Brandywine Electronics a trusted partner year after year. For all your audio needs, check out BEL.com. Total customer comfort. That's what they give me. Without Joe and BEL, I can't sleep well at night. So we appreciate all the work that Joe and the company does to help us out. UD helping themselves so far. 14-0 in front of a packed student section on the season opener here in the first quarter. They had a 10-play drive. That one an 11-play, 48-yard drive the second time they got the football.
And it was all set up by the acrobatic interception of Don Nassib. A read and react play, engage the offensive line, drop back into the passing lane, get your hands up, And not only to get your hands up and get the deflection, but to bounce it in the air, react to the football, and grab it with one hand. Oh, by the way, after he grabbed it, he tried to duck and run a little bit, too. He had the full package there. If this was last season, I might suggest we try him out at wide receiver. They had Naz Adderley taking some snaps on the offensive side of the ball during spring practice. Why not try Naz out? But I think Dave Brock's good with him at D-tackle.
Let's see if the hands can't do better on kickoff coverage, though, this time around, as a line had a 46-yard return on the first kickoff from the hands. Rolf has it teed off. It's in the air. And a line will field this one from the six this time, 10-15. Running right at the 20. Flags thrown everywhere as he gets to the 26-yard line. Jalen Kindle on the stop.
Well, you know the Delaware kickoff unit was going to be keyed up. I said that they had a flawless start to this game. Remember the big kick return. That will drive Dave Brock crazy. He cares so much about special teams, as much as any coach in the country, although maybe not as much as even the other head coach in this game, because you've got Kenny Carter. He's his own special teams coach.
During the return, personal foul, blocking below the waist, number 25 of the receiving team. Half the distance to the goal from the end of the run. First down.
And that's a true freshman, Mike Waters from Philadelphia, the reserve running back, with a big penalty to move Delaware State further back with 3:14 remaining in the first quarter, and DSU already down 14-0.
So deep or bad field position for Delaware State. He went low on Ray Jones there on the outside. Good eyes from Michael Atzenrase down there on the sideline. And if you're Dell State right now, what more could go wrong? And that's why I was a little surprised we didn't get a chance to talk about it, but why they would defer the way they did to start the game and risk digging themselves an early deficit, that's not something you normally see from a big underdog.
Hornets will start their drive, first and 10 from their own 13. It's a line running wide to the left side. He's chased down from behind by Troy Reeder. He was the flag bearer as the Hens came out of the locker room holding that Delaware State flag. He's from Salesiana, and he makes his first tackle of his young career as a Blue Hen.
Of course, a familiar name in the first state, both because his dad started Delaware, and he and his brother were dominant in the high school ranks at Salesiana, and now Reeder back from Penn State. He's going to be a heck of a player.
Epperson in shotgun to a line outside right, shifts and gets the 15. Bilal Nichols was there. Last man getting up, Blaine Woodson as well.
These linebackers are special, Scott.
They are.
Anthony Jackson was out of position that time, and yet he still was able to shed the block and set the edge and force the runner back to the inside. That's an incredible athletic play. Doesn't show up on the score sheet, but that was a heck of an effort by Jackson.
Third down and 7 for Daniel Epperson and the DSU offense. Just the 5th play of the first quarter offensively for the Hornets. 3rd and 7 from their own 16, down 14-0. 2 minutes left, first quarter. Epperson going to keep this time. And you're not going to outrun the linebacking core of the Delaware Blue Hens. He is stuffed by Troy Reeder back at the 19.
Interesting decision. Elaine, it's a read option that time, and he went to the heavy side of the field. Elaine looked like he might have had some space to the outside on the left. And the keeper, just no chance whatsoever. I mean, Bell in the open field, he's going to make that stop almost 100 times out of 100.
So Delaware will be back to return a punt for the first time this season, and Jamie Jarman is a deep man. Didn't return any punts last season. Delaware struggled in the punt return category a season ago. Jamie Jarman going to give it a try. The kick is up, and Jarman going to let it bounce at the 45. He won't be able to return, although he is giving chase. Takes a DSU hop to the 30, 28, and down at the 29-yard line. So the punt from Fidel Romo Martinez, the true freshman, 53 yards. Not a bad way to start off the career as a punter for Romo Martinez, a freshman from California.
And that's the one thing Delaware's got to work on. You got to come up and catch that ball there. If you're Ray Jones, you can't let that bounce on turf. Jamie Jarman, he got an extra 15, 20 yards worth of field position down the drain. Now, it's better to get out of the way and not fumble the football, but that's something that Dave Brock was talking about, that they're still not quite there yet. It's a work in progress at this juncture.
Delaware takes over for their third drive. First two have gone pretty well. 14-0. Delaware leads it. They'll start this drive on their own 29. And it's Thomas Jefferson in, tripped up from behind as he gets past the 35 to the 37-yard line. And about seven on the first run of the ball game for Thomas Jefferson.
You talked about it in the pregame show, Scott. You know, there's an embarrassment of riches at that running back position. And Jake Trump's dad came up to us right before the start of the broadcast and said, hey, don't forget about the offensive line. And it really is easy to fall into the trap that just drooled over the running backs, and understandably so. But it's a phenomenal job up front in the early going by the Hens.
He said it very kindly, by the way.
Oh, absolutely. Big smile on his face.
Joe Walker under center as there's some movement. I believe Delaware State jumped a bit before Walker snapped the football.
I think they got it deuced.
Before the snap, false start, number 82 offense. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
No 82 on the offense, so somebody moved in blue, but wasn't anyone wearing number 82, that's for sure. Perhaps Charles Scarf, 85.
Could have been Scarf, might have been Jefferson. He might have inversed the numbers out on the edge, I think was the movement.
So Delaware, their first penalty offensively, backed up. 22 seconds, first quarter. It's been all blue ends in the first 15 minutes. See if Delaware runs a play. Looks like they're going to try to as the clock ticks down to 14. Second down and seven, ball at the Hens 32-yard line. Walker out of shotgun form. Jefferson stands next to him, and now a timeout going to be taken by head coach Dave Brock.
Down to one on the play clock. I think the Hens offense relaxed and thought they could let the quarter expire, but there was a difference play clock to game clock, so Brock called the timeout for the sideline.
Well, we got a break. Want to tell our listeners that earlier this year, my wife and I moved to a new home where the master bedroom was painted a bright yellow color. I love my Blue Hens blue and gold, but not necessarily when I'm trying to sleep. So we called on J. Michaels Painting. Owner Mike Purvis, a University of Delaware graduate himself, provided us with a free color consultation. With his expertise, we were able to agree on a color that we love. His painting crew came in the morning, and by the time I came home from work, my kitchen, office, master bath, and master bedroom were all done. If you have any painting needs, be sure to visit jmichaelspainting.com. 7 seconds left in the first quarter. Let's take a look at some stats. Delaware, 130 total yards of offense, 4 for Delaware State, 103 on the ground, 5 for DSU. The Hens have 27 yards through the air. Joe Walker, 3 of 4 for those 27 yards. DSU, minus 1 through the air. And that was the first penalty against Delaware. They've had the football, the Hens have, for 11 minutes, 59 seconds. DSU out there on offense for just 2 minutes and 54 of the first quarter. It's been all Hens. That's what we wanted to see on the very highly anticipated start of this 2016 campaign.
Yeah, absolutely. And the offense has pretty much lived up to its identity. The pass has been able to hold its own. They converted that big third down. They got a nice hitter on the outside early, and then it's been ground and pound since.
After the timeout, Walker back to throw. Screen pass to Jefferson, 30, 35. Lowers his head and gets out to the 37-yard line. Tackle was made by Cameron Rogers, and that'll do it for the first quarter of action. All Hens through 15, 14-0 is your PNC Bank timeout score.
Welcome.
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
And a goal! It's Delgado with his second.
Blue Hens Football, 94.7 WDSD and iHeartRadio.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium, where the score is 14-0. Hens on top as we get ready to start the second quarter of action. I want to remind our listeners that Fuddruckers, home of the world's greatest hamburgers, is located right off of Churchman's Road on Jeffrey Drive in Newark. We want you to try the Blue Hens Burger of the Week at Fuddruckers, the American Kobe Burger with bacon and cheddar, a 100% American Kobe beef burger topped with smokehouse bacon and cheddar cheese, specialty burgers, exotic burgers, and build your own burger combinations, limited only by your imagination. Email us at udfootball@wdsd.com and you could win a Fuddruckers gift card today. Hens opening up the second quarter, third down and about three from their own 37.
I got a stat for you here, Scott. In Dave Brock's first three season openers as head coach of the University of Delaware, the Hens were outscored in the first quarter by a combined 42-0. Here today, they're up 14-0 over Delaware State. The future is now. Is that not a big difference? Talk about getting off on the right foot, getting some confidence for this team early. It's amazing how big a difference it is when you're playing from in front rather than trying to play chase before this you've even exhaled to start the season.
I form on third down. Hens perfect on third down thus far. Excuse me, two of three on third down. They'll go to Jefferson. He shifts past the blitzing linebacker, but won't have enough for the first. It's going to be fourth down and two to go from the 37-yard line. And we'll see Will Stevenson, the transfer punter from NC State, for the first time.
Only the second time, really, we've seen significant penetration in the backfield. And Jefferson had to stop, couldn't get any momentum going. And as strong as he is, as good as he is at running through tackles, when you have to stop your feet like that, really hard to run through anything.
I asked Coach Brock, how do you replace Eric Anderson? He quickly said, you get Will Stevenson. He's very proud of the transfer punter, and you can see why. As Rutherford, back to return, catches it, falls backwards. They'll spot it at the 11. And the first punt as a Blue Hen for Will Stevenson goes 52 yards. Stevenson did not play at NC State, graduated. He's a graduate student for Delaware, and the kicking game looked really good so far. 52 on his first punt.
52 with about 5 seconds of hang time. 52 net. No even semblance of a thought to try for a return. That's as good a punt as you're going to find.
DSU going to switch running back and quarterback. Kobe Lane in the game for the first time. Mike Waters is the running back next to him as DSU starts first and 10 from their own 11. Waters, the true freshman, was Lane to the right side. Tackled by Charles Bell for a loss. That's his second tackle for loss already. Charles Bell has two tackles, both for loss.
I mean, Bell has been flying all over the football field, chasing guys down left and right. Honestly, I think he got cheated out of a tackle or two. Remember, he had that big hit on the first play of the game defensively as well. I think Bell and Reeder have been awesome so far.
Second down and 12. Down 14-0 are the Hornets. And Lane, the lefty quarterback, all day to throw. Downfield, has a man wide open. Rutherford dives to get it. Slides, and he's down at the 40-yard line. If he hits Rutherford in stride, that's a touchdown. A break for the Hens. Instead, 31 yards on the pitch and catch from Lane and the transfer Rutherford.
Busted coverage. Trey Jones fell asleep on the seam route, and Delaware dodged a big bullet.
Lane, the lefty, backup quarterback. They go to Waters. Waters looking for space. Cam Kitchen came over with help from Troy Reeder to make that tackle. A one-yard pickup to the 41. You know, Lane is the backup quarterback, but Kenny Carter, the head coach at DSU, said, we have two good quarterbacks, not necessarily a starter quarterback and a backup quarterback. The Hens knew coming into this game they would see both Kobe Lane, the sophomore from Georgia, and Daniel Epperson, the junior transfer.
And both lefties, too, which is nice as a coach, because if you have two quarterbacks that are going to play, one's left-handed, one's right-handed, it really changes your entire offensive system because all the shifts and protection, all the drops, everything changes. So it's a rarity for the defense to have to face two guys that are lefty. I got to say, it was a great find. It was really bad first toss.
In shotgun form, Lane on second and 9. Hens showing some pressure. It'll be Waters running wide to the right side. He gets to the second unit of the Hens and down at the 49-yard line, just shy of the first down for DSU. They've yet to get a first down in this game.
They love this kid out of Philadelphia. They think he has a chance to be absolutely special. They say he's so shifty, ran for over 3,000 yards in his high school career.
They'll go quickly on third down and one. Under center is Lane for the first time. He bobbled the snap. Ball came loose. Delaware has it. Second turnover of the day for the Hornets. And Maurice Harley gets the football for the Hens.
I don't think he ever got the snap. I think that was why he went so low initially on the quarterback sneak. I think he was trying to find the football, and I think it just got kicked amongst the scrum into the backfield.
For DSU, you get the big play and you can't make anything off of it.
They're going to review that. Maybe he had possession on a knee before it was able to squirt into the secondary. I didn't see it. It sure looked like it was a clean fumble on the snap, but the replay officials want to take a peek.
And a makeover to this broadcast booth over the summer is the limited seating that they already had here in the Blue Hens press box, now even more limited because of all the great new replay equipment that need to be installed.
They walled off the corner over there on the right side. I walked towards the restroom they have in this fine facility and was shocked. I thought maybe half the press box disappeared or something. I didn't know they had to wall off the replay, but that is a rule in the NCAA. They have to be separated from the rest of the press box.
Maurice Harley is the player that picked up the football, the junior from Upper Marlboro, Maryland. Played in the secondary really sparingly over the first 2 years here at Delaware, and they moved him from safety to linebacker this season for 2016. He did force a fumble on special teams against New Hampshire a year ago, but he picked up the football there, and we can only hope for Hens fans that the ruling stands.
Either way, the Hens are going to get
after
the football
review,
back.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
But that's better because it much improved field position. Instead of the long field, you started out near midfield and an opportunity to go pound it on the Hornets again. You've been playing downhill all night long. I would like to see a couple of throws on this drive. I know you're dominating them run the football. I think you've established that you're capable of doing that. You threw it when you needed to on the first drive, but I wouldn't mind seeing a couple of passes mixed in.
Hens will start the drive on their own 47, 12-41, second quarter, 14-0 lead for the Hens. Hills back in as a running back, and Walker under center. It's Hills running fast to the outside, hammers a defender, and he's down with first down yardage into DSU territory at the 41. Absorbing the blow is Keewon Selby, the sophomore from Bear, Delaware.
Did you get the feeling that Wes Hills went looking up Keewon Selby? He had the opportunity to miss him, but nah, Hills hadn't been hit enough, so he just lowered his shoulder and ran directly through the chest of Selby. He went Earl Campbell on him.
Delaware in DSU territory again. Riley Angeline in for the first time. He moved from tight end to wide receiver in the offseason. Walker from the 42. Design run to the right side, spinning across the 35, and down he goes at the 32-yard line. Might be enough for a first down. It'll be close if not. They'll mark him just shy, 9.5 yards for Walker.
Here's that opportunity now. Do you go play action? Do you give Walker that opportunity to try to take a shot down the field? Because, to be honest, where you're on the field, you're in three down territory. You got three plays to pick up 1 yard. I like Delaware's chances on third and four if they need to. Do you give the ball to Walker and let him get some confidence throwing it?
Hills is a single back behind Walker, but Randolph is split out to the left side. Randolph caught a touchdown pass a season ago from Deontay Cherry. Hills has a first down, spins across the 30 and down at the 29.
Easy for me to say up here when you get paid to win the football games and you know you're going to pick up a first down. You might as well keep the high percentage stuff going. And again, just a magnificent job up front. They put Randolph out on the edge, so you got the field about as spread as Delaware is going to make it with the three wide receivers. And just too much open space for Hills. First time they only had seven guys clogging the middle of the field.
Hills averaging 7 yards per carry. Two tight ends set, three tight ends set for Delaware. Single back is Hills on first and 10 from the Hornets 29. Walker to Hills. Hills a stiff arm, and he gets back to the line of scrimmage. First man there was Selby, looking for a bit of revenge. That's the first time that DSU has really contained Hills towards the line of scrimmage.
And they did a good job to use the boundary as their friend that time, and they just kind of strung it out. But the danger of stringing it out on Hills, he's so good at cutting back, and you have to be flawless as a team, and that was good team pursuit that time. There was just no avenue for Hills to try to go back against the green.
Hills is the running back, standing next to Walker in shotgun form. 14-0 Blue Hat, second and 10 from the Hornets' 29-yard line. Trips to the outside left. Walker looking that way. He throws. It's caught by Cherry. Cherry makes a move at the 20, and the Hens are back into the red zone. A yard shy of the first down. Tackle again made by Selby.
And see, that's the difference this year to last year with Joe Walker. He's 4 of 5, 32 yards. That's not overwhelming. But last season, that throw was at Deontay Cherry's knees. And he's got to slow down, go low to get it. Maybe he catches it, maybe he doesn't. Here, it's at the chest, it's in stride. He has the opportunity to use those jets, make a guy or two miss, and instead of a yard or two, he gets none.
First catch of the year for Cherry, who led the team with 30 a season ago. Third and one, Jefferson picks up the first down to the 19. And the drive continues for the Hens. That was the sixth play of the drive. They've gotten 35 yards thus far.
What did Dave Brock say about Thomas Jefferson this week? I loved it. He says he does things you'd usually attribute to a much smaller back. But that's exactly what that was there. Big guy in space, just stops on a dime, little jump cut. Not trying to hit the home run, just trying to make sure he picks up the first down. But that's tough to get that much weight and muscle stopped and moving in a different direction as quickly as he did.
Owen Tyler is the tight end. Angeline in the slot. Split out to the left is Jamie Jarman. Cherry on the right side with Walker in shotgun form. Walker has to tuck. He's going to run at the 20. Big block picked up. Cuts it inside the 15. Down at the 13-yard line. Tackle made by Javon Barnes. Nice block by Deontay Cherry, the junior.
Boy, Cherry came back, picked him up. Walker, they were trying to get a screen to the outside. Wide receiver screen. Good read by Walker. Saw Delaware State had it. Flooded that direction. So go back where the numbers aren't, to the other side of the defense. And Cherry, that's what you love about these wide receivers. Last year, they really struggled to catch the football, but they did not shy away from contact. They're very physical blockers. Cherry and Jarman have done a great job of it the last year plus.
Single back is Hill. Second down and four from the DSU 13-yard line. Hens up 14-0. Hills up the middle this time, across the five, dragging a defender into the end zone from 13 yards out. Wes Hills makes the lead for the Hens 20-0.
Huge hole up the middle. Hills hits it like he was shot out of a cannon. And then, again, small guy running through contact, just dragging people to the end zone. Well done by Wes Hills as there's an injured Hornet down near the five-yard line. But, you know, that's what we talked about last year. I understand that Delaware lost the game where Hills was able to play against Jacksonville, and the offense didn't look great, but he was such a difference maker, and to be without him for 10 games the way Delaware was, and to not be able to prepare for it, to kind of get stuck on the fly. Jefferson, Randolph, and Williams did a great job filling in, and they're all very good backs, potential all-CAA backs if they got the carries to get the stats to do it. But Wes Hills, I mean, he's got a little Brian Westbrook in him. You know, Westbrook, remember when he played in back in the old A-10 games? He was just so shifty, so fast in the open field. And I think Randolph right now at this stage of his career, about a half step behind Westbrook, but not too far. And that's an awful high compliment.
A Newark urgent care injury timeout as Abdul Aguilero was injured on the play. The sophomore from Brooklyn, New York, appeared in two games as a true freshman a season ago, being helped up by his teammates. He'll have a long walk to that DSU sideline on the far side of the field. 8:19 remaining in the first half of football here in the second quarter. And look at these numbers, or listen to them, as Delaware up 20-0. Hills 13 carries, 90 yards. He's averaging almost 7 yards per carry. That was a 13-yard run into the end zone on the eighth play of the drive, a 53-yard drive that started with a Maurice Harley fumble recovery on third down and one for DSU.
And Hills is getting his work in now, because I don't think he's going to be very active in the second half. I'm pretty confident in saying that. The beauty of it is you take a Hills hat, you got Randolph waiting in the wings behind him, Thomas Jefferson. They'll carry some of the load through the third quarter, and then we'll see some young guys in that fourth period that they get the chance to step in. And I know they say, oh, it's a little early to be talking about that. I don't see how Delaware State can get this thing turned around. It's 17 minutes to 4.5 in time of possession. And Delaware dominated time of possession last year, and it wasn't always a good thing. Tonight, it is a very impressive thing.
Rago back onto the field for his third try at an extra point. Rago was 16 of 17 a season ago on PATs. Will Stevenson will hold. Tim Sheridan is a long snapper. It's been 4 years since the Hens didn't have Joe Fortunato snapping the football. Sheridan, 2-of-2 so far. 3-of-3, hold is down. Kick is up into the student section, and the PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 21, DSU nothing. 8:19, second quarter. They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 2:55. At 2:56, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
Is now on 94.7 WDSD.
The International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and its contractors provide the best trained, most competitive, and safest licensed electricians in the state of Delaware. IBEW Local 313 electricians will safely get your job done right on time and within budget. Visit IBEW313.org. 8:19 to go in the second quarter. 21-0 Blue Hens. West Hills in the ground attack have really done it on the offensive side. Defensive pressure and turnovers dominating the first half as well.
Very impressive. Honestly, I don't know if I could be much more impressed by what Delaware has been able to accomplish to this point. One busted coverage, one poor kickoff coverage, and one punt that they didn't catch in the air that they let roll an extra 15 yards. Those are the only three negatives I can think of right now. It has been about as clean an opener as you'll find.
Back to return for DSU. Maybe the only bright spot so far for DSU was that 46-yard return by Bryson Aline.
Yeah, because they had the long pass, but even that was kind of overshadowed by the fact that it should have been a touchdown. It was underthrown, and the receiver fell down to catch it.
Jake Roth will be kicking left to right into the student section. Aline is the deep man. Roth, who will handle kickoffs this year. Also, we might see him this year for longer range field goals, although Frank Reger did a nice job as a freshman a year ago making 10.
He's been skying the kicks. I mean, all types of hang time. You get the feeling he could kick it into the end zone if he wanted, but he's going for the hang time instead.
Another good one from Roth. This one into the end zone. Booted that one to the end of the U and Blue Hens in the end zone. And DSU will be back on offense, where they have gotten only 46 yards of total offense and 31 of them coming on a single pass.
And that was more the drive kick that time instead of the looper high up in the air. He put his foot behind that one, and he almost kicked it through the end zone. This kid's going to be special. You know, Dave Brock, I was giving you a hard time because they ran that commercial up on the video board during the last break of you and Coach Brock for the coach's show on Wednesdays, and he didn't have a big smile on his face. He's not a big smiler. He smiled when he talked about that kid this week. He thinks he's going to be good.
You're right about that. He reminded me, hey, make sure you ask about Jake Roth at the coach's show. Epperson back in, pumps once on first down. It's Rutherford again, open in the middle of the field. Simba makes the tackle, but in Delaware territory at the 45, flag dropped late. How about Mason Rutherford? Two catches in his first game as a Hornet.
That's got to be sideline. That came at the end of the play, near the sideline, 50 yards away from the play.
Sideline warning, Delaware. This is the warning.
You're hearing the voice of Carlton Derrick, the referee in this game. We'll get an update on an injury when we have time to get down to Michael Atanasio. Right now, 21-0. Delaware leads 8-12. Second quarter, shotgun for Epperson. He's looking to his right side, throwing on the out route. Aris Scott can't handle it. Let's quickly go down to Michael Atanasio on the sideline.
Guys, Bilal Nichols did not go down on the field. He made his way back to the sideline after a fourth down conversion, but it seems like he's out for the rest of the night. Injured right foot, and he has his shoes off and his helmet is not with him, so I don't think we'll see him the rest of the night.
Sure hope that's precautionary.
Yeah, with a lead of 21-0, we hope that that Newark urgent care injury update is not long-term for a big part of this defense. Bilal Nichols all-conference a season ago. Waters on second down and 10. No room to run. Anthony Jackson wrapped him up, but Woodson was there, as was Ryan Torza. It's going to be third down for DSU at the Delaware 43.
That's another thing about Dave Brock. He doesn't like stats unless they back up one of his arguments. And one of the stats that he does seem to enjoy is that Bilal Nichols is not included amongst the returning starters, stat that we love to quote so much. And he's the guy that was selected preseason all-conference.
Yeah, Nichols, 29 tackles a season ago, but two forced fumbles, 1.5 sacks, 2 tackles for loss. The junior from Hodgson. Wishing him the best. Third down and 8 for DSU from the Delaware 43, down 21-0. Epperson can't outrun the Delaware defense. A sack by the Hens. And it was Cam Kitchen, the sophomore.
The Cam Kitchen, just a motor on that kid. He just does not quit on plays. As he looped around the center of that D-line and went all the way wide and then came back on a sharp angle, chased the QB down from behind. For a big fella, he's got pretty good foot speed and he moves well laterally, which is something that's always important for a defensive lineman. Mike Atanasio will tell you about that. You got to have good and quick feet.
20 tackles a season ago as a true freshman, now a starter in his second year. And a big play from Kitchen. Fourth down and 15, ball at midfield for Romo Martinez, who had a kick above 50 yards the first time.
It's number 32. 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
That's a quick 40 seconds.
Yeah, delay a game for Delaware State. So all that does is give Romo Martinez a little bit more room to try to pin it. With 6:36 remaining, second quarter, ends up 21-0.
Del State's been shifting pre-snap on every punt just to try to keep Delaware from getting too much a rush.
Benny Papali is back to return. It was Jarman the first time. Papali runs up on it. Fair catch, diving for it at the 23. And still, the punt return came not as smooth as Coach Brock would like. A 32-yard punt by Romo Martinez. But Delaware offense back on the field with 6:29 left in the second.
Bill Parcells used to keep a guy around when he was with the Giants by the name of Phil McConkey for that one reason, because he could come up and catch the punt absolutely no matter what. If it was short, he'd come sliding up just like Papali used to there. He could go back on the ball. He used to figure with the wind and the AstroTurf at Giants Stadium, it would save him an average of 200-300 yards a season. Papali, you know, a step late coming forward, but he had confidence he was going to catch that ball. Now, that's a risky play. You better catch the footballer. You might want to go back to the other sideline instead of the Delaware one and not discuss things with Dave Brock, but he did save Delaware about 10, 15 yards of field position by making that catch.
Hey, while we've got a moment, if you think you're the Blue Hens' number one fan, stop into any of the 82 businesses in People's Plaza and register to be the People's Plaza Fan of the Game. You can win a UD football prize pack and be honored at Delaware Stadium during the next home game. In fact, today's People's Plaza Fan of the Game was Jennifer Copson. Visit peoplesplaza.com. So 6:29 remaining in this first half. It's been all Blue Hens. Walker's 5 of 6 for 41. Hills 13 carries, 90 yards. This is the game number one that Hills got injured in a season ago against Jacksonville. Still in that game, he had 16 carries for 88 yards. An average over 5.5 yards per carry in that game. So the stats on game number one looking good again for Wesley Hills. He is not in. Randolph will be the single back as the Hens will start their drive on their own 23. Hens will start with Papali in the slot. Jarman out to the left, Cherry to the right side, and Walker under center. It's Randolph. running at the 30. Clobbers his teammate, Cherry, as he makes his way to the 35-yard line. Cherry, wrong place, wrong time, and the big Jalen Randolph, 6'1", 230, all of them into his teammate, Deontay Cherry.
I think he was a little too keyed up. He assumed that's an inside the tackles run. There's going to be some contact, going to have to run through somebody. And he got 10 yards before there was anybody in his vicinity, and poor Deontay Cherry paid the price for that pent-up emotion from Jalen Randolph.
Kyle Taylor will get a half tackle. We'll give the other half to Cherry. Now there's some movement by DSU.
Well, that is not going to make Kenny Carter a happy camper. That's a defensive tackle directly in front of the football, unless Delaware center squeezed it.
Offside, number 90, defense with contact. Five-yard penalty. Still first down.
Michael Atanraze used to line up on the defensive line all the time. Mike, how do you jump offsides when you're directly in front of the football like that?
There is no excuse for that. I know the coach on the DSU side is flaming right now with anger. He's right over the ball. He should be looking directly at the ball. There's no need for that.
It's the second time we've called Dominic Drury's name. Young team for DSU. And some young penalties against this Hornets team. First and five from the 39 in Delaware territory. It's Randolph patiently running to the left side. And he was brought down by Jahad Nybauer at the line of scrimmage.
How about that, Scott? Sure looked like Joe Walker changed the play right there at the line of scrimmage. At the very least, he made some sort of an adjustment. I understand it didn't work out that great. It's only a two-yard run. But here's a guy last season that was only given half-field reads and basically one or two wide receivers. At that time, either a dummy audible to switch to cadence or, you know, shifting sides, maybe even changing the play. I like the field generalship from Walker.
Second down and three for Delaware from their own 41-yard line. Alex Sheets, the transfer from William and Marion for the first time. As Walker will go, play action. All day to throw, tossing to an open Jarman. The connection is made, but he bobbled and dropped it. That had number six, had six written all over it. Oh,
poor Jamie Jarman. That's the best route Jamie Jarman's run in more than a year as a wide receiver. Stuck the foot in the ground to go to the outside and then goes straight to the post. Burnt the defender. You can't throw it any better if you're Joe Walker. It was a long handoff. Jarman did everything but catch the football. He was trying to get to the end zone before he looked at it.
Walker couldn't have gone up the field and placed the ball any better than that. Jarman with the drop. The fans in shock. And now out of the Wildcat, it's Hill getting some yardage back at the 40. 30 has a blocker at the 20. 15, 5, Wes Hills! Touchdown, Delaware, 59 yards.
We went to practice a couple times during the offseason. We saw Delaware working on all these different trick plays and different formations that they were trying to install. And there were some struggle points that they were having with them. But boy, did they work hard on them. And it pays off the first time they go to the bag of tricks. Wildcat with Hills lining up. And you have to love it. You drop the touchdown. You're deflated. And Dave Brock, Sean Devine go right back to kind of pick the team up by helping them out with the trick play.
Wes saying, I got you, Jamie. I got you. No problem. 59 on the run. Hills up to 149 in the first half. And the Hens are up 28 to nothing. That's your PNC Bank timeout score with 4:46 remaining in the first half.
Brought you here today to get your honest opinion about this new car. To keep things unbiased, we removed all the logos.
Feels like a BMW.
Reminds me a little bit of an Audi.
So this car supports Apple CarPlay.
Siri, open maps. Wow. She gets me.
It also has teen driver technology. It even mutes the radio until the seatbelts are buckled.
I'm very curious what it is.
This is the 2016 Chevy Malibu.
And it sells for?
It starts at
$22,500. What?
Oh, wow.
I mean, all this technology.
That's a game changer.
Little details, truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
You wanted excitement week one? Well, we've got it for you. Hens up 28-0. There was a drop pass on a touchdown that would have been by Jamie Jarman. And on the very next play, Hens go into their bag of tricks. And the Wildcat leads to a 59-yard score by Wes Hills. Four plays, 77 yards. And the Hens up huge with 4:46 in the second. Kicking this one away. A line will take it from the 4 at the 10. 15 has some space. That closes in quickly as he approaches the 17-yard line. Tackle made by Eric Patton, a two-time All-State performer at St. E's here in Delaware.
Tell you what, Joe Walker on that last throw to Jamie Jarman, it was so accurate that even an old defensive lineman like Michael Atenraze was singing his praises during the entire last commercial. He could not say enough kind things about Walker, how good that throw was. And I was impressed because he stumbled on the play action, kept his poise, kept his balance, and fired a dart.
Epperson dumps it off to a line who jumps to get it, and he trips at the 19-yard line. A line. A smaller guy in stature, just 5'7", 170, had to jump to get it and lost his footing.
I've learned many things from Michael Atenraze over the last year or so, but the thing I've learned more than anything else, it's not a myth. Defensive linemen legitimately don't like quarterbacks.
4:15 and ticking, second quarter. Epperson with trips to the right side. Throwing left, it's Scott with his first catch of the day. First down yardage across the 35 to the 37-yard line, and it was Malcolm Brown who made the stop.
Really good patience on that throw that time. Reeder had underneath coverage, and he just waited for Reeder to clear on that skinny post and then delivered a strike, really drove the ball.
Epperson, 4 of 6, had that early interception by Nassib. He's been on target since. Epperson over the middle, and it's intercepted by Anthony Jackson. The third takeaway by this Delaware defense.
Great job by Jackson. He just kind of fooled him into making that throw. He thought he had an open guy on the seam. Jackson reading his eyes the whole way, broke on the football, came underneath. And that's just great underneath coverage. I mean, to have underneath leverage like that, time it perfectly, and then jump in the passing lane, you can't do it much better than that. And this linebacking core, man, they are so deep, so athletic, great ball skills, I think might be the most impressive part.
Anthony Jackson, a junior from Maryland, 53 tackles a season ago, second on the team. He starts alongside Bell and Reeder, and he gets the INT. Delaware will start from the DSU 49-yard line, up 28-0. And it's the CAA Rookie of the Year, Jefferson, patiently finding some room and wiggling his way up to the 41-yard line. An 8-yard pickup on first down.
Thomas Jefferson looked like he was playing Tecmo Super Bowl there, just going up and down and weaving his way diagonally through the defense. I think he made 4 cuts on an 8-yard run.
Jefferson, 890 yards rushing as a freshman. He climbed up the depth chart after injuries to Hills and Randolph. And what a great freshman campaign he had. Now a redshirt sophomore. Second and 2 for Delaware at the DSU 41-yard line. 3:11, second quarter. Jefferson again gets across the 40. They're going to mark it there, so a yard shy of that first down marker will be 3rd and 1.
We'll have to wait and see, but looking at Wes Hills over on the sideline, he just got congratulations from about 5 or 6 different teammates. I was going to say I think he might be done, but here he comes right back into the football game. He had his helmet sitting there on the bench. He runs back, he picks it up, and he runs into the game. They're going to go 2-back set.
Jefferson will stay in. Hills popping that helmet back on. 149 yards on 14 carries and 2 touchdowns. That's a good week. It's been 1 half, but he'll be back in the game. And he'll go Wildcat again with Hills on 3rd down and 1. Hills adjusts in the backfield and gets enough for the first down. He's up over 150 yards now on the day. There's a player down.
Oh, one of the offensive linemen went down, kind of got pretzeled up that time. It was Mario Farinella. And hopefully he's all right.
Farinella, the only player that didn't start last season. He started one game at UNC. The sophomore from Bloomfield, New Jersey, out of Bergen Catholic. Youngest player on the line. He's 20 years old. Criminal justice major. He's a big guy, 6'6", 3'10". Getting his start today. Brock making his way towards him. He looks like he's in some pain. Great training staff here. Dan Watson in his 13th season. Dr. Andrew Reisman in his 11th year with the Hens. This is Newark urgent care injury break with 2:22 remaining. In the first half, it's been all Blue Hens, and they've been getting great push up front by this offensive line. Farinella now sitting up, and hopefully he's all right. With Farinella out, they might move some things around. It looks like Jethro Pepe might come in, the 6'7", 280-pound sophomore, a tackle on the roster, so they might move some guys around to play guard. We'll see how they line up. Farinella hopping with the help of the training staff. We'll try to get a Newark urgent care injury update for you when we can.
I hate to see that. It's such a physical game and just traffic center of the field, and Farinella, it just looked like he got kind of caught and twisted up in that middle of the pile. There was nobody near the back of his legs, which is always what you fear most, but he went down in a hurry.
So it looks like Bozic will move to that right guard position. And Jethro Pepe will play the right tackle spot. On first down and 10 for Delaware on the DSU 37-yard line. Walker calling out signals to his teammates as the clock ticks at 2:10 first half. Some pressure coming from DSU. They were all over Jefferson, but he made something out of it. Got past the line of scrimmage. First man there was Cameron Rogers, the transfer from Wesley College.
Now, if you're the Hens, you want to execute this two-minute situation here. You're in plus territory at the 36, but you got under 2 minutes left on the clock, two timeouts at your disposal. Put this in the end zone here. You want to certainly make sure you get points, but it'd be nice to kind of finish this strong after such a magnificent opening half.
141 and taking Delaware up 28-0. We see true freshman Chichi Amici from William Penn into the game for the first time. Bunch trips to the right side. He'll stay with Jefferson, shifting left to right as he cut it back across the 35 to the 34. It'll be third down with the clock ticking.
Well, this is only the second third down passing situation Delaware's been in all night. They've stayed so far ahead of the chains. They haven't been in many of these third and mediums. They've been in virtually no third and longs.
Delaware 5 of 7 on third down today, 1 of 1 on fourth down. And there's 60 seconds remaining in this first half of action. Hill's back in the game. He'll stand next to Walker, who's in shotgun form. Cherry goes in motion from right to left. They need 7 yards from the DSU 34. Walker going to throw. Pressure coming from left side. He avoids it, at least momentarily. Now just gets rid of it, avoiding the sack. As pressure was coming from Cameron Rogers. And actually Denzel Burgett, the sophomore, from the right side.
Kind of no man's land here for Brock. It's too far to kick a field goal. You don't want to punt from the Del State 34, so you probably keep the offense on the field here.
Looks like that's what they're going to do. Fourth down and 7. Delaware a season ago, just 5 of 15 on fourth down. They're perfect today on their only try. Jarman will check back in. Hills remains the running back. Owen Tyler on the field. Papali and Cherry. Walker looking over at the signal from the sideline. And now he gets into the huddle. Clock stopped at 41 seconds. And a whistle. Timeout taken by Delaware.
Your PNC
Bank. Timeout score with 41 seconds left in the second quarter. 28-0 Delaware.
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any two. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
just tuning in or want to watch this or any Hens All Access broadcast from the start, visit our YouTube channel at youtube.com/UDBlueHens.
For Blue Hens Football, 94.7 WDSD and iHeartRadio.
All Blue Hens here at Delaware Stadium so far, as it's 28-0. 41 seconds left, and Delaware, after calling a timeout, going to bring the punt unit out on 4th and 7 for the DSU 34. Will Stevenson on the field.
Del State just in safety mode right now.
Hens thought about it. It looked like before the timeout the offense was going to stay out there. But they'll give it to Stevenson, who punts it high. We'll see if Delaware can get under it. It lands in the end zone. So a touchback, 34 seconds remaining. Don't go anywhere at the break. We've got the IBEW Local 313 halftime report. We'll talk with head coach Dave Brock on his way to the locker room. Michael Attenrouse will have him. That interview presented by Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com. What a first half of football, Matt.
And phenomenal effort by Delaware across the board. The only slight concern right now is that they've gotten a couple of wide receivers open, but the pass rush has really picked up and kind of covered up a lot of that. And tackling's been fantastic. They got the early turnover, and then offensively, they've just dominated the football game up front. They've hit big plays on the ground, and I know it was a drop, but Joe Walker's looked good. Perfect throw, shooting it down the field. A lot to be encouraged by.
First and 10 for DSU. Empty backfield, five wide for the Hornets as Epperson will toss it. It's caught by a line. He breaks a tackle of Bell, shifts his way past the 32 to the 35. He's a good ball player. And sophomore Bryson Aline, a hometown guy at a Concord High School, Paul Warlow's alma mater.
What a 16 in-state players on the Delaware State roster.
Yeah, a lot of in-state
timeout,
players.
Delaware State.
There's a timeout taken by DSU. They'll stop it with 27 seconds left. Of course, a lot of pride in this game. There's a trophy involved. The rivalry certainly didn't work out as well as I think marketing staffs at both schools would have loved it to. The Route 1 rivalry name has kind of gone away, and that's because of the dominance by Delaware. But you can't say there's not a whole lot of pride, especially for those in-state players. 23 for Delaware, 16, as you mentioned, for DSU. These are guys that might have been teammates in high school, certainly played against one another, and now do it at the college level. That's pretty special.
And I do think that there is a better fit now than there had been because of the fact that Dave Brock recruits in-state so heavily, and you're seeing the same thing from Kenny Carter. For so long, really, these two teams didn't have many in-state players. Delaware might have three or four. Delaware State would have seven or eight, and you felt like that was pretty much the list. And now between them, 25, 26 guys from the first state and good players, not just back end of the roster filler guys, but I mean meat and potato guys on this roster. I mean, look at Delaware. Their starting safety is from Hodson and Ray Jones. The Reeder brothers are on the team. I mean, they are stacked from the first state. Del State's arguably their best players from Delaware.
The DSU back on the field after timeout, first and 10 from their own 34. Emerson wants to throw again, and he is hit hard. Down he goes, a sack by Armin Ware, who coach said had one of the best summers of anyone on the team.
Not sure who was running the music, but they were playing Fill Me a Buttercup
timeout
during that play.
Delaware State.
That was an odd one. I'm not sure why Delaware State takes the timeout here. I understand you're trying to work on things at this juncture, but you're going to get the football to start the second half. You're down to 19 seconds left in the half. You're backed up inside your own 30-yard line. What's your best-case scenario here? I guess a 50-yard throw, and then maybe you get a field goal afterwards. You do have one timeout left to work with. It just seems like you'd be better off to mitigate your losses and try to regroup at the half.
And just to finish your point about the quality of players from the state of Delaware, an interesting fact for the Hens. Before Coach Brock was coach of the Blue Hens, the Gatorade Player of the Year Award, only one player that won that trophy ended up playing for the Blue Hens. That was Greg Peden back in 1989. Since Coach Brock has become head coach, three more, four total Gatorade Players of the Year have played for the Blue Hens. Two are on the team right now, and Jamie Jarman and Colby Reeder. C.J. Jones transferred in from Boston College. That's special. You can get kids to walk on, but to get these top-notch players from the state of Delaware to keep them in state, very impressive what Coach Brock has done in his time recruiting as Hens head coach.
And he said right away, we are going to get the best players in Delaware and keep them. And I don't think it's a coincidence. Remember, when he was at Rutgers, Scarlet Knights were taking guys out of Delaware's backyard left and right. He comes from Rutgers. He understands how to recruit this state. He attacks it. Delaware's got some really good players out of it.
After back-to-back timeouts by Kenny Carter, 19 seconds left. It's second and 17 after the first sack of the career of Armin Ware. Epperson with pressure coming. Dumps it off to a wide receiver, and it's Bell who makes the stop at the 32. It'll be third down and long if they want to go for it. And they're going to hurry to line with 4 seconds. Why not? They clocked the football with 1 second left.
I don't think they got it in.
Had they
gotten it in, it would have been to be fourth down. That was not good clock management.
I know the official, Carlton Derrick, just said that's the end of the first half. He almost said it towards Kenny Carter. That's the end of the first half. Why don't you talk to your team after a 28-0 start for Delaware over the visiting DSU Hornets in this in-state rivalry game. We're going to take a break, but not before we hear from head coach Dave Brock. This interview at the half is presented by Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com. And Michael Attanarase is waiting for coach in the end zone. He's got to be very pleased with the performance of his Blue Hens team. Let's send it down to Michael Attanarase, who's with Coach Brock.
Hey, Scott, I'm here with Coach. Coach, what a way to start your 2016 season. Tell me about it.
Well, I feel good. The kids are playing really hard, really physical. Three turnovers on defense, making a lot of plays, tackling really, really well. Gave up a couple passes, but we got out of those shots. Running the ball really well. We're throwing it well. We just haven't thrown it much, and we dropped one that would have been a touchdown, and we just got to keep grinding. Come out in the second half, establish the line of scrimmage, both sides of the ball, and then go get it for 30 more minutes.
You held the DSU to just over 100 yards in the first half. What is the defense doing to do that?
Well, I mean, we're fast. We tackle well. I mean, they got 65 yards and two pass plays. I mean, we take away the two pass plays, they don't have much. I don't even think they played 25 plays. So, we just got to keep grinding and keep doing a great job and control the ball on offense and go put some more points on the board.
Talk to me about Walker.
Joe's doing a great job managing the games, checking probably 75% of the runs, putting us in great plays. Wes and those guys are running like crazy, like we would expect they would. And then he's managed it. He's got a couple third down completion conversions in the passing game, threw a beautiful strike that we didn't catch. And we just got to keep grinding. We got a shot. We got a chance to take some shots. We'll take them.
All right. So what is the message in the locker room right now?
Lock in and go get it for 30 minutes.
All right. Thank you, Coach. Scott.
All right, let's take a timeout at the half. 28-0, Delaware leads. It's IBW Local 313 halftime report with the Hens on top. Hello, everyone, and welcome to BlueHens.com. You're watching Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. I'm Scott Klatskin here with head coach Dave Brock. It's good to be back.
Great to be back.
Well, I should say I'm glad to be back. You've been here working hard all summer long. We've seen some great coverage on Hens All Access of your scrimmages, of your practices. What was your take on how the summer went?
Well, I've been thrilled. The guys have been here all summer, worked really hard, made an awful lot of progress. Ted Perlack and his crew in the strength area have done a great job. Dan Watson, the athletic training, the medical staff. We're as healthy as we've ever been. So I think we've made great progress and we've had a great training camp and really excited and looking forward to the Delaware State game.
Well, since the end of last season in 2015, you've taken on a different role at those practices, and that's quarterbacks coach. How do you feel like your presence has affected those quarterbacks?
Well, I think, one, I'm enjoying doing it. I'm enjoying being back on the field, interacting with the players, coaching a position group. So I've really enjoyed it, and I think the kids have gained a lot of experience from last year and have gotten a lot better, certainly through practice this year and two scrimmages. There's been a lot of improvement. We're very healthy at wide receiver, very experienced at running back and an offensive line and tight end. So there's a lot of reasons for the improvement. And again, we just need to make sure that the improvement they've shown so far this summer carries over, to Thursday night, September 1st.
And you thought they threw the ball pretty well last scrimmage. That's good going into the first game of the season.
Yeah, I mean, they did. They went out and really performed well and made a lot of catches, had a lot of opportunities to throw and catch and made a lot of competitive catches, a lot of contested catches, and a lot of great decisions. So really happy with that group and what they've done and look to build on it, as we have the last couple of days here to get ready for Delaware State and put together a great plan that'll make sure that their strengths are utilized and we'll go get it.
Well, let's talk about the running back position, because here we are, very similar to how we started last season with Wes Hills, Jalen Randolph, Thomas Jefferson, and looking to redshirt Kareem Williams. Now, things didn't work out, but we're still pretty darn good last season for the Hens, with Thomas Jefferson ending up with the Offensive Rookie of the Year award and Kareem Williams coming in, playing because of the injuries to Wes and Jalen, and having a heck of a season as well. But this year, what will a healthy Wes Hills and Jalen Randolph bring to this running back group?
Well, I think the fans understand how talented those players are and the value that they'll add from a football perspective. But, Jalen and Wes are two of the leaders on offense, two of the most respected players on our team. So, there's an awful lot of value in the locker room. There's an awful lot of value from a standpoint of being out there competing every day and giving that leadership value to the younger players or some of the more, inexperienced players. And they've both looked fantastic. Wes is in the best shape of his life. Jalen looks great. Thomas is right back in form and we've really rededicated ourselves the last couple of days to running the football and it's looked great in practice. So we're excited about those guys. We're going to try and redshirt Kareem again. He's been fantastic, had a great scrimmage the last scrimmage. So, he's right on course with what we want. And again, I feel like that's one of the best rooms on our team and we're looking forward to them having a great year.
Let's talk about the guys blocking for those players up front. The offensive line returns 4 out of 5, and another that started a game on the road a season ago. Tons of experience up front.
Yeah, no, those guys have worked really hard. I think they've changed their bodies. A guy like Jake Trump has really come into his own after last year starting. He's really improved his game. He's had a dominant summer. Obviously Connor Bozick's an all-conference player and is somebody we're going to count on for senior leadership. There's very few seniors on offense, but he's somebody we'll count on. And Brody Kern's kind of the quarterback of the front. So those guys are ready to rock and roll. And Mario Farinella started the North Carolina game last year. He'll be in there at right guard. Will Lewis is a veteran player, started multiple years for us at left guard. Jethro Pepe is ready to go at tackle after 2 years. Learning how to play and getting bigger and stronger. And Steven Robinson's in a position where, we feel like he can line up and play for us. So, we feel like we got 7-8 guys that we can roll with and feel really good about. And we're excited to get going.
We talked a bit about the passing game. Now let's talk about the wide receivers. There were some injuries, a lot of drop passes, inexperience last season at the wide receiving core. After a summer of getting better, of practicing, of scrimmaging, how do you feel like this wide receiving core will be better in 2016?
Well, I think the way you do is you go out and do it. I mean, confidence isn't going to come from somebody telling you can do it. I mean, confidence comes from you doing it and successfully doing it and then, being able to do it consistently over time. So I think what we've seen in practice is an incredible amount of improvement, not only from the receiver position, but, the quarterbacks are more accurate. They're quicker with their decisions. I think we're doing some things that are going to lend it a little bit better to their skill sets and so far so good. It's worked out really well and it's exciting to see the improvement. It's exciting to see them play up to their capabilities and now as a staff we got to do a great job to give them a plan that they can go out and execute on September 1st.
To help out with catching some passes this season, you brought in a transfer from Rutgers, Charles Scarf. 14 catches, 100 yards, and a touchdown last year for Rutgers, fifth leading receiver on that team. Tell us a little bit about your new tight end.
Yeah, Lancaster guy, and we were fortunate to be able to get him. He had a bunch of choices that he could have made, and he chose Delaware. And he's come in and done a great job. He's been an impactful player so far this summer. He's made some great plays in the scrimmages and very competitive guy, a team guy. Can play multiple positions, can play wide out, can play tight end, can play in the slot. So we're going to have to be very creative in terms of how we want to use him. And the more opportunities that we can create for him, I think the more impactful player he'll be.
He's a big target, that's for sure. We're looking forward to seeing him and the offense improve in 2016. We're going to take our first timeout. When we come back, we'll take a look at that defense of the Hens. You're watching Under the Lights, driven by Chevy.
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
We brought you here today to get your honest opinion about this new car. To keep things unbiased, we removed all the logos.
Feels like a BMW.
Reminds me a little bit of an Audi.
So this car supports Apple CarPlay.
Siri, open maps. Wow. She gets me.
It also has teen driver technology. It even mutes the radio until the seatbelts are buckled.
I'm very curious what it is.
This is the 2016 Chevy Malibu.
And it sells for?
It starts at
$22,500. What?
Oh, wow.
I mean, all this technology.
That's a game changer.
Welcome back to Under the Lights here on BlueHens.com. Scott Klatskin with head coach Dave Brock. We talked about the offense. Now let's talk a little bit about that stellar defense that you've got. Now, last year we spent a lot of time talking about how you want every position to look like the depth you had at the running back position. And do you feel like you're there now, especially on the defensive side of the ball?
Yeah, I mean, we feel like we've got an awful lot of guys who can play on defense. And we have a tremendous amount of experience coming back. You know, guys who've started for us. Multiple games, at least a full season, some two, three seasons. We have a lot of guys coming back who played 250, 300 snaps in a year. So we feel like we're going to be very competitive from the front line back to the second level of the defense to the secondary. I think especially on defense on the second and third levels in the secondary and at linebacker, you know, that probably depth now mirrors what we have at running back. At linebacker, we feel like we have at least seven kids who can play for us and competitively get the job done. And then the back end on defense, we feel like we have at least eight, I think any one of those, probably six or seven guys in the secondary could start for us. I think probably any one of six guys at linebacker could start for us. And we love the guys we have up front. So we're excited about the defense and they've had a great summer. It's been an incredibly competitive camp. It's been all ones-on-ones. We haven't done any, ones-on-twos or scouts or anything. We've tried to, really put the kids in a position where they had to compete and fight and claw for everything they got and wanted to have a great view of what we thought we might be able to be offensively. And the only way I felt like we could do that is to go out and scrimmage against the number one defense every time. So feel great about them and really looking forward to watching them play.
Tons of depth at that linebacker position. Charles Bell returns. He led the team in tackles with 94 a season ago. Anthony Jackson, Jalen Kindle, Larry Spears, Jason Thompson. And then you go ahead and you add Troy Reeder, a guy that was all rookie team in the Big Ten last year from Penn State and a former champion and all state player at Salesianum. What will Troy Reeder bring to that defense?
Well, I mean, he's a special player. There's no question about that. He's very, very talented. I think he's going to improve us, as a football team from a defensive perspective. But he's an elite kid. He's a great guy in the locker room. He's a leader. He's a passionate kid about football. He practices the right way really hard, and he's acclimated himself. So, he's really a dynamic kid in the locker room now with the other players and smart. He knows exactly what he's doing. So we're counting on big things from him. And obviously, Charles is a returning all-conference player, and we feel great about him. Anthony Jackson's moved to the field linebacker spot, and he's done a fantastic job in camp. Jay Kendall's ready to rock and roll. And as you said, Larry Spears, Jason Thompson, we feel fantastic. Colby Reeder, who we signed as a freshman, he's flashed incredibly in the summer. So we feel great about that position group. We really think that they can do some things for us, and we're looking forward to them having a great year.
Well, taking a look at the secondary, you've got seven, eight guys that could start anywhere in this conference, and you've got players that'll be here this year and next year and even the season after that. A lot of depth, a lot of young talent on that side of the ball, and one of the guys that I forgot about when looking at that depth chart was Malcolm Brown. Only a sophomore, he had a stellar freshman year. What does he bring?
Well, again, I think Malcolm's the right person. I think he does a great job from a competitive standpoint. He started for us as a freshman and was an impactful player. You know, had an interception for a touchdown, made a lot of plays on the ball. So I think when he comes back, he adds size, he adds length, he adds speed. He's a very competitive player. So with him and Jay Watt and Nas, I mean, you have three corners that I think could start just about anywhere in our league. He's the right guy. So we're excited that he's back and excited that he has three more years as well.
You didn't lose a lot of players last season to graduation. The only group that really got hit was the defensive line, losing Tinsley, Plummer, Hollerman. But you still have the returning players and all-conference players in Blaine Woodson and Bilal Nichols. Could those two have some pretty big breakout seasons?
Well, I certainly hope so. I mean, they're both returning all-conference players. And I do think there's something to the theory that if you're strong up the middle on defense, you're going to have a really good football team. So I certainly think we are. John Nassib's played a ton of football for us, and Cam Kitchen's ready to go. And Aaron Donaldson, who we brought in this class, will be a player that we think will impact the game for us. So we feel really good about that. Grant Roberts has had a great camp. We had three redshirt freshman defensive linemen that we think will be impactful players. So, you know, we feel really good about the defensive line. We feel good about the defense overall, and nothing that they've done in training camp gives me any reason to believe otherwise.
Let's take a look at the special teams. Eric Anderson, everyone's favorite punter, he left after his junior season, did graduate. So he was one of the best players at that position in the CAA for years. How do you replace a player like that?
Well, with Eric, I mean, obviously he was not only a great player, but he was an incredible person. You know, he was one of the leaders from a community standpoint on our teams, one of the leaders in terms of outreach and some of the things he did. So, you know, I'm hoping that we can replace him with a multiple group of people in terms of the other things he did. On the field, you know, we brought in Will Stevenson from North Carolina State, and he's had a fantastic summer. He's in graduate school, doing a great job getting his MBA. From a standpoint of special teams, our coverage teams, you know, we feel like we have more players available to us from a size speed ratio that we've ever had. So it should be incredibly competitive to be on the front 11 in kickoff coverage or the front 11 in punt coverage. So we're working like crazy on the punt returner. That was an area we were deficient last year. Really like the guys we have back there. They've done a good job. So we got to get them out there September 1st and see what they got.
Well, talking about this defense, it seems like they have the opportunity to be very special this year. Does the D as a whole have some specific goals they'd like to reach this year?
Yeah, I think they have their own individually from a defensive perspective. But I think from a program perspective, what I've talked to them about is, you know, they were a top 25 defense, last year in all the statistical categories that we feel are most valuable. And I've talked to the kids, the coaches, about going from good to great, you know. And we've gone from 100th in defense 3 years ago to 60th, 22nd, you know. And now it's time to be a top 10, a top flight defense in the nation. I think we have the players to do it. Even though we're still young, we're very experienced. And those guys have done a great job. So, you know, we need to go from good to great. And that's going to give us our best chance to be a playoff team, which is what we think we should be.
All right, Coach, we talked about our team. Let's take a timeout. When we come back, we'll take a look at the CAA and our first opponent, Delaware State. It's all coming up on Under the Lights, driven by Chevy.
Welcome.
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today, you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
And a goal! It's Delgado with his second.
Well. Welcome back to BlueHens.com. You're watching Under Lights, driven by Chevy. Scott Klaskin with head coach Dave Brock. We talked about the Blue Hens. Now let's talk a little bit about what's going on in the CAA and the schedule this year as far as the teams that Delaware will face, and what a tough schedule it is. Not a day off ever in the CAA, but looking at the Hens schedule, no favors for you guys. You've got three of the top 12 teams in the country all on the road, plus a difficult game to end the year, as it always is, against Villanova in a matchup that might be Andy Talley's final game as a head coach after 31 years. So it's a tough schedule, that's for sure, for the Hens.
Well, you got to play who you have to play. I think realistically, when you look at it, you know, the league's tough from top to bottom every year. You know, teams beat teams. You know, Richmond goes on and has a great year last year. I think they were fifth or sixth in the preseason poll, you know, the previous year. So, you know, you really have to, you know, you have to get into the season, you have to play the games, and you know, you really have to play well every week and find a way to win those games. And if you do, then you'll be where you want to be at the end of the year. But, you know, when you play in a league like the CAA, I mean, that's the way it is. It doesn't matter the order you play them, or, you know, I don't know that it matters a whole lot of whether you're on the road or not. So they're tough games every week, wherever you are, and we're looking forward to the challenge.
Well, the CAA schedule makers didn't do any favors for the Hens, and really, the Hens didn't do ourselves any favors either with the schedule. You play at home on September 1st, won't be home again until October 8th. Because of that, and of course it's important to win every game, but how important is it to make a lasting impression week one on the fans that come out to watch you play against Delaware State?
I think it's important that we play the right way and have a great night on September 1st, without question. You know, again, it's challenging when you play one game in the first 5 weeks. And you know, again, at Delaware, I don't know that you should ever have five home games. But, you know, we got to battle through it this year. And the schedule is what the schedule is. You know, again, we're ready to do what we need to do. We're excited about the year. You know, we'll play whoever comes up. And we're looking forward to it.
Your first opponent, Delaware State University, 43 newcomers, most of them freshmen. So you're going to see some new faces, new personnel. They've got some new coaches on the staff, and the quarterback might be new as well, possibly a JUCO transfer from California. What do we know about this DSU team?
Well, not a lot. I mean, Coach Carter's down there working hard and really trying to rebuild a program, I think. You know, a downright
dominant effort from UD's defense. So the two areas that Brock was looking for marked improvement, he got. And then the third was pass rush, and that started to land late in the first half. We'll see if that continues here as Del State gets a football to start the second half.
Delaware done warming up. Players are back on the sideline. Delaware State get ready to come onto the field. Kenny Carter is the head coach of DSU in his second season, a tough year in his debut, just 1-10. They won that final game of the year versus Howard by a point, finished 1-7 in the MEAC, trying to improve on that. But this is a young DSU squad, 43 newcomers on the team. Now, some are older players. Two JUCO transfers have made an impact for DSU, but a lot of freshmen on this team and a lot of new players for Kenny Carter. For Dave Brock, this is the year. He's been telling everybody 2016 is the year Delaware returns to the playoffs, and, well, they've made a statement towards that goal in the first half of football. Still two quarters to play here at Delaware Stadium. It's opening night, the season opener for Delaware. And the Hens will kick off left to right towards the student section. Bryson Aline will return for DSU. Jake Rolfe will kick things off, the true freshman. And Delaware fired up on special teams. There won't be much let up in the second half with a 28-0 lead. Not with this Dave Brock coach team.
That's why you want to see an impressive start to the third quarter. Get a stop, get a touchdown, get another stop, and then start get the reserves into the football game. Because remember, you have to go on the road next week at Lafayette.
Jake Roth kicks this one away, boots it. And out of the back of the end zone, the leg of Jake Roth. A walk-on freshman kicker, and he's got quite some leg on him. DSU will take over.
Does not seem to be a ton of wind here tonight, but he clearly likes kicking to the Bob Carpenter center, because that's two touchbacks going that direction now.
Daniel Epperson, the starting quarterback in this game. He'll start the second half. Epperson, the sixth starting quarterback at DSU over the last four seasons. Tough to win ball games when you're rotating quarterbacks in and out like that.
Now, the old saying, if you don't have... Or if you have two quarterbacks, you don't have one. Delaware State really believes they have two talented guys, but Kenny Carter couldn't settle on one. It looks like that has been done for him in that first half.
Epperson, two interceptions, but he did complete 68 yards, 6 of 9. Otherwise, only one pass fell to the turf, at least, out of Epperson, two interceptions. And they'll start off the second half with a line running right side. He picks up maybe 2 to the 27. Troy Reeder, his fourth tackle.
And in Epperson's defense, the first interception, while it was a poor throw, it needed to put more air underneath of it. It was a ridiculous play by Nassib. It should have been an incomplete pass. 9 times out of 10, it would be. But Nassib just tipped it in the air to himself.
Second play of the second half for DSU. 2nd and 8 on their own 27. Two wide receivers to the near side. Epperson, some time to throw. Now, no time at all. It was Armin Ware again, the second stack for the sophomore from Middletown.
He said that Ware had as good a camp as any Delaware defensive lineman that Dave Brock has seen in his tenure with the Hens. He could not heap enough praise on him, both in his press conference and then when we talked to him in his office afterwards. He likes this kid. He thinks there's an opportunity if he can carry it over to the games, which he has so far tonight, to have a big-time season.
Third down and 15 for DSU. This defense has been amazing thus far. And they'll run the football on third and very long. It's Ware again in on the stop. Ware, a 19-year-old sophomore, lived in Middletown. Family wanted him to go to school in at St. Joseph's Prep. So he made the commute from Middletown. Attended high school in Philadelphia. Walked onto the team and 5 tackles last season. Now he's obviously a major contributor to this Delaware defense.
That is a long ride to school every morning.
Nice plug for St. Joseph's Prep, I guess. Tells you. Good school out of Philadelphia. Fourth down, punt in the air. Gets a DSU roll. The 35 down at the still rolling 30-yard line. And thanks to some lucky bounces, some good kicks so far from Fidel Romo Martinez. 46 on that punt, and Delaware's offense will be back on the field starting at their own 30.
Again, you have to come up and catch the football, though. It cost you 15 yards there on the roll. Now, that was a little bit tougher because it didn't have much hang time. But it didn't seem like he had any inclination to come up and get it whatsoever. Now, up by 28, maybe that's part of the thought process. You don't want to take any chances. You play to the school.
Newark Urgent Care injury update. Unfortunately, we spotted Mario Farinello with some crutches at halftime. So it looks like he won't be returning. Jethro Pepe is in. Bozic moved over to the right guard position as Walker gives it to Hill. Starts left, cuts right, and gets across the 35 to the 37-yard line. Selby in on the tackle. Malik Harris also there.
Scott, can you remember seeing more effortless 7-yard runs? I mean, again, starts left, one quick cut to the right. Nobody's near him until he's 5 yards up the field. I mean, it's just dominance up front from this Delaware offensive line. 4 returning starters now. The loss of Farinella is a big deal because he has an incredibly high ceiling. Hopefully it's nothing major.
3 wide receivers, Scarf, Yoakum, and Jefferson, with Walker under center on 2nd down and 3. Hills again jumping for the first down to the 40. 2 carries and a first down for Wes Hill.
Just a little glide for 3, and I mean, when Dell State stops him for 3, it feels like a 5-yard loss. I mean, that's how dominant Delaware's running attack has been. You're almost surprised. He only got 3 yards. The linebackers have been completely taken out of the game because Delaware's offensive line is pushing the front for Dell State back, establishing that new line of scrimmage 3-4 yards down the field. It's just too much traffic for the linebackers to sneak through and flow to the football.
Cavacanti made the tackle on the play. Looks like Wildcat formation with Wes Hills at the quarterback spot and Jalen Randolph next to him. Hill's going to keep. Has blocking at the 40 to the outside 45. And just like that again, 5-6 yards per carry for Wes Hills. In fact, he's averaging 9.5 tonight.
That one's on Hills. I mean, good lead block, but that's just quickness to the corner. I mean, you get to the edge before the linebackers can get there and the safety can come up when Dell State is completely in a run defense there. They know you're going to run the football, especially in the Wildcat. They're attacking downhill. He'll just beat them.
11:44, third quarter action. Delaware up 28-0 over DSU. 291 total yards for Delaware, 250 on the ground. Wes Hills has 168 yards rushing. 2 tight ends set for Delaware. And it's Hills again, this time busting it up the middle at the 30. Stiff arm at the 20, being chased at the 10, dragged down inside the 10. Another amazing run from Wes Hills. 44 yards for the junior.
Got away with a little bit of a horse collar there at the end, and you just hold your breath. Hill's going over to the sideline. He seems to be all right. Dan Watson and the training staff came over to check on him right away, but you hate to see a guy get brought down by the nap of the neck like that, but it's really the only way you're stopping Wes Hills because they've been chasing him all day long. That was a huge hole up the middle again. The linebackers just went the wrong way.
I form now for Delaware inside the red zone for the fourth time. It's first and goal to go from the 10. Randolph shifts and gets inside the 5. A touchdown saving tackle by Niebauer. Wesley Hills now over 200 yards rushing on the day. 19 carries, 212 yards, and a welcome back performance by the junior from Ridley. Unbelievable. Still a lot of football left. Don't know how much we'll see out of Hills, but that's 2 weeks worth of effort in not even three quarters. I form again for Delaware. Second down and goal from the 4. Double tight end set. One goes in motion from right to left. It's Scarf, Yoakum, and Randolph behind Walker. Randolph driving for it, pushing for it, and Randolph will not be denied. No signal yet. A touchdown for the Delaware Blue Hens.
Great run by Randolph. He ran through like three guys. The entire pile was 4 yards deep in the end zone. The officials would not throw their arms up in the air. Everybody was celebrating. Delaware State was walking back dejectedly to the sideline. Kind of took away the moment a little bit, but now Randolph's got a couple. Everybody's getting in on it.
I was waiting for it to be official, and we never got the hands tossed up in the air. Second touchdown for Jalen Randolph. Picked up his degree earlier in the year now. Enrolled in the UD MBA Masters program, and he missed most of last season as well. Good to see Randolph back and into the end zone twice. Delaware up 34-0. And Rago back on to drill the extra point.
Reset. T5.
Ball snap. Kick is up. And your PNC Bank timeout score. Delaware 35. Delaware State nothing.
Everybody's Welcome. Got their...
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
And a goal! It's Delgado with his second.
Blue Hens Country, 94.7 WDSD.
.958 remaining in the third quarter. Still a lot of football left, and it's 35-0. Delaware over Delaware State. Let's send it out of the sideline, and Michael at Rossett.
Guys, what you can see right here is a dominant performance by both the offensive and defensive lines for the University of Delaware. As a defensive lineman, I always say it starts in the trenches and ends in the trenches, and you know what? That is true when it comes to the game of football. The guys on the offensive line are dominating Delaware State's defensive line, opening up creases, getting to the second level. The Del State's linebackers have no vision because they have O-linemen on them 2 seconds after the ball is snapped. These guys are doing a great job.
You know who's got to be loving it? Obviously, Hills, Randolph, and Jefferson, because they're getting all the stats. But Joe Walker, I mean, take the snap, you hand the football off. He's got as good a view as anybody. Just kind of sit there and, wow, we are whipping them up front, because that's exactly what Delaware is doing, just pushing them off the football, dominating. And these aren't crevices. These are gaps that they are running through, these backs. They're making good cuts. They are running through guys. It's been impressive from the backs, but the offensive line really has been the story.
Said it starts in the trenches and ends in the trenches. It's been ending in the end zone for Delaware. 35-0. And there's still 9:58 remaining in this third quarter. This is the performance we've wanted to see. A lot of expectation for this team, returning a lot of players, and they have not disappointed in the season opener. Roth boots another one. This one will land in the grass behind the end zone. What a kick by Jake Roth. While we've got Michael Attanase, we want to send it back to him for a Newark urgent care injury update. Bilal Nichols, anything on him?
Guys, Bilal Nichols is on crutches. He has his shoulder pads off. His helmet has been taken from him. So we're not going to see him the rest of the night. I hope all is well. It'll be a shame to lose two linemen in the first game.
Thank you, Mike. Newark urgent care injury update. Bilal Nichols, a junior from Hodgson Votech, a major part of this defense on the interior. All-CAA third team. We hope the best for Bilal. Now it's Epperson to start the drive. Overthrows his target, and Adderley couldn't get under it for the interception. It'll be second down.
That was such a bad throw. Adderley couldn't even intercept it. I mean, he was playing center field back there and just kind of waiting to break on the football. He overshot his receiver by, 15 yards? Adderley was 10 yards behind him, couldn't open up in time to go get it.
Nasir Adderley, a heck of a freshman season a year ago. The sophomore, 19-year-old from Malvern, Pennsylvania. Third on the team as a true freshman last year with 51 tackles. Good to have him back. Malcolm Brown back as well. Epperson on second down and 10. Ball on the 25-yard line. The lefty is on the run. He's hit as he tosses. Second INT of the day for Anthony Jackson.
That one was set up by pressure, and the pressure came from Aaron Donaldson. Speed off the edge was all over the quarterback, Epperson, as he tried to get to the outside. Now, that's a ball, if you're Epperson, you've got to throw away. You're outside the pocket, but a good job by Jackson. Keep an eye on the quarterback and where he was going to go with it. Just an easy break, but all set up by the pressure of Donaldson that time.
And Matt, you said watch out for the transfer from Coastal Carolina, Aaron Donaldson, making his pressure felt.
And Newby, they just got him. And they knew he was a good player, but Dave Brock said, we didn't know that he had that dynamic of a skill set. And just, the ability to kind of go at an angle off the edge. He beats guys out of the break.
Single back is Jefferson as this drive starts in DSU territory. Walker throwing towards the end zone. Cherry, did he haul it in? He did! A touchdown for Deontay Cherry. We waited a long time for the signal, but we got what we wanted to see. What a grab from Deontay Cherry. And the toss from Walker was on point.
Love it. Love it, Scott, from Joe Walker, because what you have is man coverage. Go up and give your wide receiver a chance. He throws that football perfectly, and then Cherry going to grab it with the hands in single coverage and tapping the toes. The officials weren't sure. I'd be surprised if they don't look at this one, because it took them forever to make that call. But a heck of an effort by Deontay Cherry, and I just like that Joe Walker showed faith in Deontay Cherry to throw that football.
And they are going to look at it. It did take a long time for the referees to signal, if they did at all. They took a long time on an easy one when Randolph walked into the end zone, but we'll have the referees look at the replay. What a job by Walker to place it, and Cherry to go up and get it. Nice job. While the officials are reviewing this one, a reminder to our listeners that at St. Francis Healthcare, they get their emergency patients out of the waiting room and into treatment fast, averaging a wait time of less than 32 minutes, and stroke and heart attack patients are seen immediately. Their dedicated team of doctors, nurses, clinicians, and administrators coordinate seamlessly across all departments so you get the care you need. St. Francis Healthcare, we treat your emergency with urgency.
Well, they just showed it up on the big board. That looked like a catch. That was a phenomenal grab. And again, that's a throw Joe Walker does not make last year.
The call stands. Touchdown, Delaware. Joe Walker with his first touchdown pass of the season. He had one total last year. That was to Trey Brown. In fact, no players on this current roster had caught a touchdown pass from Joe. And the first is a highlight for sure. 41-0, Delaware, 9:38, third quarter. Wow, what a grab from Cherry. Extra point, it's partially blocked, bad enough to go through, And your PNC Bank timeout score, Blue Hens 42, Hornets nothing. They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
Football, 94.7 WDSD and iHeartRadio.
Delaware up 42-0 over DSU. What a toss by Joe Walker. Even better catch a moment ago by Deontay Cherry. Walker now 6 of 9 for 66 yards and a touchdown. Stryker listening on 94.7 WDSD. And we've got listeners all over the country and across the world, I found out, thanks to the iHeartRadio app and BlueHens.com. It was a pleasure speaking with John McElvaney, who I met when he was shopping at National 5 and 10. He told me his son, First Lieutenant John McElvaney, a 2013 graduate of University of Delaware, listens to the Hens games in Afghanistan. Lieutenant McElvaney, thank you for listening and thank you for protecting this country. I thought that was pretty neat, and I'm glad I ran into John McElvaney, his son, a Blue Hen fan, and listening right now in Afghanistan.
Great country, isn't it, to have good Absolutely. People like that have our backside so we can watch some football.
And we've been watching a good game out of the Delaware Blue Hens. A great game, going from good to great. How about that? That's what Coach wanted in week one. 42-0, 370 yards of offense for the Hens. 304 on the ground, 66 through the air. None better than that last pass from Joe Walker to Deontay Cherry. 9:38 remaining in the third quarter, and it's 42-0, Delaware.
I just have this weird feeling we're going to see a touchback here, Scott. I don't know what brings that to my mind.
He's been blasting them towards the student section. And Roth will do it again. That one just barely touched the blue in the end zone as he booted that one through. Let's get a scoreboard update now. Some other games are going on around this year. Yeah?
Well, Jack Cosgrove has retired, so new coach at Maine and trying to make it a heck of a debut. Black Bears are tied with UConn 7-7, 5:57 left to go in the third quarter. Maine with the football as they are trying to pull off the big upset. Stony Brook taking on North Dakota. Not North Dakota State, but still a good football team. They're tied at 7 early third quarter there. And William & Mary was tied 7-7 with NC State for the Wolfpack, scoring the final 21 points of the first half.
Kobe Lane back in for DSU. First and 10 from his own 25-yard line. The give is to the running back. No, Lane's going to keep it himself, excuse me, as he gets across the 27-yard line. Tackle made by Larry Spears. Spears, part of what makes his defense great is Coach Brock always rotates players in. He doesn't put too much into starters. Larry Spears did not start, but was fourth on the team in tackles a season ago, and he makes his presence felt, that's for sure.
He tells guys all the time, look at number of snaps, not who starts the first snap.
Lane in shotgun form on second down and 8. This time he will go to the running back, and he's got some room at the 40, keeps it in bounds towards midfield. He was caught from behind by Aaron Donaldson, showing some speed from that defensive end position. Caught the running back from behind, but not before a line got his longest run of the day out to midfield.
Now, Dell State, now if you're the Hornets, you're just working on stuff. I mean, they have at times executed a couple of nice plays. They've just done nothing consistently, which is something you're not surprised by with such a young team.
There'll be a line again running left. Nowhere to go. Kitchen clobbers him for a loss back at the 45.
But what I like about Kitchen is he gets to the outside and he forces the ball carrier back inside, setting the edge, but then he goes makes the tackle too. A lot of guys will force you back to the inside and then rely upon their pursuit. Kitchens good enough, athletic enough to be able to do both, and in a big package, too. That is not a small guy lining up on the outside.
Kitchen at 6'2", 260 with a sack and a tackle for a loss. Second down and 13 after the tackle by Kitchen. And it's going to be Lane, the quarterback, with not a whole lot of room to go. A flag is thrown as he gets into Delaware territory at the 49. His helmet falls off.
I think we have a face mask, Scott.
You think that's how the helmet got rolled?
He ripped his helmet clear off his face. It was a heck of a cut. And good effort by the Delaware defense, but Lloyd Batson grabbed all masks.
Face mask, number 93, defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. Automatic first down. Number two's helmet came off due to a helmet foul. Therefore, he may remain in the game.
Just a second penalty of by Delaware today. Last year, Delaware, very disciplined on defense. Only 8 first downs due to defensive penalties, which was the fewest in the CAA. Lloyd Batson playing in his first game as a Blue Hen, the redshirt freshman from Caravelle Academy, with the tackle. And Mike Lanarase helped coach him
and
when playing, he was at Caravelle.
And playing well in spite of it.
He didn't teach him how to do that. He didn't teach him how to do that face mask, that's for sure. First and 10 in Delaware territory at the 34. Lane letting it fly. It's high. He has a man, and it's knocked away at the last moment. But they're going to throw a flag. Watson was there to break up and prevent the touchdown. He had 8 pass breakups a season ago, but they're going to throw the laundry.
You can face guard as long as you don't make contact before the ball arrives, and it looked like he
pass
kicked the ball, then the
defense,
contact
defense, number 22. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
If you're going to get the wrong end of a bad call, you want it to be when you're up by 42. They show the replay up on the board. Nope, that's good defense.
Yeah, that's good.
Come
defense.
On. That's perfect timing by Watson. The receiver stopped, and it's an anticipatory call because that's most of the time when the corner will run through the receiver. But Watson had good body control, and he was able to slow down, got the deflection before the contact.
Back-to-back penalties, Batson and Watson. Gets Delaware State into the red zone for the first time this evening. 7:49, third quarter, ends up 42-0. Lane throwing towards the end zone, knocked away this time again by Watson. They're again going to throw a flag. Back-to-back penalties on pass breakups that look clean from up here, at least, by Justin Watson.
The only thing I'll say on that one, there was a turn of the upper body, so I'm not sure if he maybe got a little bit of a hook on the back, and we're kind of shielded from being able to see that.
Pass interference, defense, number 22. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
But it was close, and they owed him one, so you think they would give him the benefit of the doubt.
Mike's down on the sideline quickly. Did you see anything that would indicate a penalty?
Yeah, guys, it was slight. It was a slight wrap. I would just say that he was slightly out of position. Being on the outside, it was an inside throw, but not enough to warrant a penalty. Not in a situation where you just gave up an uneven call.
It puts Delaware State first and goal to go from the 4-yard line. Lane, the keeper, starts left, and he's hit as he moves to the right. That's Nasir Adderley with the tackle for loss back at the 6.
Wow, Shavano came in to help out as well. It's like there's an injured body down on the field, but you're not going to reverse field against this Delaware defense. They're too disciplined and too fast. And when you start trying to give ground and go across the other side of the field, that's where bad things are going to happen from an offensive perspective. And Lane is still down.
Yeah, player down is the quarterback, Kobe Lane. Lane, 2 of 2 through the air, 31 yards passing. His last two tosses has resulted in penalties thrown against Delaware. Their third and fourth penalties on the defense, respectively. And now he'll be walked to the sideline, so Epperson will have to come in.
Looks like a cut above the eye. They got a towel that he's holding up against his face as he walks over to the sideline.
It's our Newark urgent care injury break as Epperson comes in. Second and goal to go now from the 6. DSU trying to get on the board in this in-state matchup. Down 42-0. Clock ticking in the third at 7:25. Epperson, the lefty, throwing the football, lobbing it up, and Rutherford holds it in for a score. The first touchdown of the season for Delaware State.
Nice double move. Starts inside, then goes back to the fade, back corner. He had a size advantage on the smaller corner, Watson. And they've played together before, so they have that kind of synergy. And give credit to the quarterback coming in cold off the bench after the injury. And Epperson threw a good ball there to the back pylon.
Epperson and Rutherford, as you mentioned, played together at San Bernardino Community College a season ago. Rutherford caught 53 passes from Epperson. They're more familiar with each other than the rest of the team is familiar with one another, as there's 42 newcomers on this team. But DSU gets on the board, and the extra point is up and through. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 42, the Hornets 7.
Brought you here today to get your honest opinion about this new car. To keep things unbiased, we removed all the logos.
Feels like a BMW.
Reminds me a little bit of an Audi.
So this car supports Apple CarPlay.
Siri, open maps. Wow. She gets me.
It also has teen driver technology. It even mutes the radio until the seatbelts are buckled.
I'm very curious what it is.
This is the 2016 Chevy Malibu.
And it sells for?
It starts at
$22,500. What?
Oh, wow.
I mean, all this technology.
That's a game changer.
Little details, truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Delaware football. The future is now on 94.7 WDSD.
Best drive of the day for Delaware State. Couple penalties helping out. In fact, three penalties on that drive helping out Delaware State. But six plays, 75 yards for the Hornets, and they score for the first time in 2016. Delaware up 42-7 after Daniel Epperson came in for an injured Lane and found his former JUCO teammate, Mason Rutherford, in the end zone. Now DSU will kick things off, and Adderley is back to return, running to get it at the 8-yard line, 10, 15, 20-yard line, and he breaks one to the 25, 30, running strong at the 35, and that's where Delaware's drive will start with 7:10 remaining in quarter number three.
Kind of see why they took a look at Adderley on the offensive side during spring game, with some reps at wide receiver just to see what they had, because they're so deep in the defensive backfield. By the way, we were talking CAA scores earlier. App State's not FCS anymore, but it's opening day. Top 10 team on the road. They're beating Tennessee 13-3 at the half. How crazy would that be?
That is an upset alert, that's for sure. Anthony Castro, our former producer, is somewhere upset at halftime. A big ball fan. 7-10 left in the third. We'll see Blake Rankin for the first time. He comes in under center with a give to Thomas Jefferson, starting left, looking for holes and can't find much. Gets to the 40-yard line, a pickup of 5 on first down. Blake Rankin, the redshirt senior, battling last year. Started, in fact, the game against Jacksonville. Lost his starting spot, and Joe Walker didn't look back, although passing game only 67 yards per game a season ago. Now Rankin getting reps, and it was late in the summer until Coach Brock announced that Walker was the starting quarterback, and a lot of competition helps, I think, out both players in summer camp.
8 days ago was finally when Walker submitted the starting job. Brock made it official. Rankin, though, is capable. He'd come in off the bench. He doesn't have quite as strong an arm, not quite as athletic as Walker, but he's accurate. He makes good decisions.
Rankin under center on second down, and here's Thomas Jefferson into DSU territory at the 35. Brought down at the 30. By Keywan Selby. Thomas Jefferson getting into the running attack to a 30-yard rush by the sophomore.
Thank you for the decision there by Rankin. Turn and hand the ball to Thomas Jefferson. Good things tend to happen when you do that. And on that last run, that was just an explosion to the edge by Jefferson. But on the previous one, what I like about Jefferson, he is such a patient runner, right on the verge of tentative, but he's not. He makes those decisions, and then when he sees the hole, he attacks it, and he's able to accelerate quickly. And it's what makes him spring so many big ones.
First and 10 for the Hens in DSU territory once again, this time at the 30. 5:45, third quarter, and Jefferson leaning towards the 23-yard line. Tackled by Malik Harris, leading tackler a season ago for DSU. Thomas Jefferson, last season the co-offensive rookie of the year, first offensive rookie of the year since Andrew Pierce in 2010. He shared the award with Zach Bednarczyk. The rest of the CAA could thank Delaware for Zach Bednarczyk, because John Robertson was injured late in that game against the Hens early in the season a year ago.
Got him some experience, and he's trying to quarterback Nova and Andy Talley's last year.
Second and seven for Delaware from the 27-yard line. Randolph pitter-patter as he gets to the 23. Randolph, not a whole lot of carries today. That's his ninth, but two touchdowns for the graduate student.
How fun could that be, by the way, if Delaware is in position to get to the postseason and if Villanova's in that same position? Talley's last game, one last wild battle for the Blue to close out the regular season in front of a packed Delaware Stadium. Kind of just gives you goosebumps to think about it now. And I saw that announcement that Talley was going to retire. I was just so happy it was this year and not last when that Battle of the Blue was in September.
Now we'll go Wildcat again. Delaware with Randolph and Jefferson at the quarterback spot. Jefferson takes a direct snap, gets a block from Randolph, looking for space, and I believe he drove a defender to the first down marker, which was the 20. It was Ted Noble on the stop, but that should be enough for a first down. Delaware, it'll be the 20th first down of the day for the Hens, and inside the red zone they go.
And again, more than 2-1. Margin, advantage, and time of possession. It's a Delaware offense that helps its defense by running clock, grinding first downs, long drives, wear opposing defenses down as well over the course of a game. It's a weapon.
Rankin back under center. Single back is Thomas Jefferson. Two wide receivers on the right side on first and 10 from the DSU 17-yard line. Hens 4-4 in the red zone. They lead 42-7. Givens to the back. Jefferson pushing blockers. And looks like the ball came loose late as he got his way to the 15. Delaware signaling that they have it. Connor Bozick with his arm extended in Delaware's direction. But there's a pileup on the 15.
Jefferson landed on somebody and they came in and hit the football. And I don't think his knee was down. I think this could be a turnover.
DSU now pointing in the direction. Might see the first turnover of the day. And it will be DSU football. So a bunch of takeaways for Delaware on defense in the first time they've given the football up to the opponent tonight.
Got a guy down too. Another offensive lineman, it looks like.
No. Hardy Farinella, the starting right guard, out on crutches on the sideline. Bilal Nichols, we've mentioned throughout the day, he's standing with his teammates on crutches as well. So we have to hope for the best from what looks like Brody Kern. Last season, an all-CAA selection, third team. He's a junior, 22 years old. We talk about it in the pregame. Michael Atanarase mentioned a bunch of men on this offensive line. Brody Kern is one of them at 22, and he popped up like a man, walking over to the sideline under his own strength. That's a good sign for the starting center.
Yeah, hopefully Kern's all right, because I mean, not only is he a force up front, he's also the quarterback of that offensive line, calling out all the signals. He is so important, and you're down a body already. You can't afford to lose a guy with both the physical and mental abilities of a Brody Kern.
After the fumble by Jefferson, it's first and 10 for DSU on their own 15. Epperson is the quarterback for an injured lane. Epperson throwing it long for Scott. Nearly intercepted as step for step with him was Tenny Adelusi. And you know, with all the great players in the secondary for this Delaware team, you almost forget how good Tenny Adelusi is at time. A sophomore, four pass breakups a season ago. He had a big one in that James Madison game in the end zone. He's going to be a stud as well. They have 7-8 guys that can start anywhere in this league.
Good ball skills. He really does. He just seems to break on the football, perfect timing. And Brian Torres is another guy that you kind of forget about. He's a captain, but he just is always in the right position, coming over the top there to help.
3:28, third quarter. Epperson over the middle. It's tipped, and there's Torza. Johnny on the spot, almost got an interception, dove for it. Ball came loose after it was tipped by the tight end. Coming across the middle, Isaiah Williams, the freshman, got a hand on it. But it falls to the turf, and it's third down.
Delaware State's quarterbacks are not having a great night. I mean, that ball was thrown technically accurately, but it's a wobbler over the middle with Delaware's defense flying around. It's a lot easier said than done, running a crossing pattern, ask a guy to look up in the air for 3 seconds to catch it. The only concern of the night is they've had some guys get open.
Empty backfield, Daniel Epperson in shotgun form on third and 10. Pumping, running, being chased, and Donaldson's gonna get him at the line of scrimmage. Aaron Donaldson giving chase, coming from the opposite end and dragging down the quarterback on third and long.
And that's why you have to be dogged, because Alain released out of the backfield. He's open down the far sideline, getting past Charles Bell. If the quarterback has time to even set his feet or even square his shoulders and just lob it out in front, that's a big gainer. But Donaldson never quit on the play and has so much speed, just able to chase him down from behind.
Jamie Jarman back to return this punt. His feet set at the DSU 45. It's a low kick. Jarman bobbled it. He's hit. Ball comes loose. Looks like Delaware got there first. 32-yard punt. Not the season debut Jamie Jarman was hoping for after what looked like a solid summer, but everything else has gone Delaware's way. Up 42-7.
I like the idea. Fair catch. If he fair catches that, he can't take the hit. And then it's a much easier grab. He's got a guy bearing down on him, and he just kind of took a late peek and took his eye off the football. Came up, caught the line drive kick. That's exactly what you want to do. Just in that spot, you don't necessarily have to try to get anything out of the return. Just take fair catch, take the football on Delaware State's side of the field.
Looks like it's Jalen Randolph's turn at the running back position. Rankin at QB. He'll go under center and into the game. For the first time, we see Ricky Emerson at wide receiver. Play action pass and tossing to an open man is Rankin at the 45. 40 goes Owen Tyler, dragging a defender to the 33-yard line, showing some strength from the sophomore from Connecticut and moving the chain on first down.
Just refusing to be tackled. That was impressive. That was Mark Bavaro-esque. Literally had a guy on top of his back and just kind of dragging him for a little ride. That's a strong kid.
Tyler, one of three true freshmen to play on offense last season, along with Polly and Jamie Jarman, gets his first catch of the season, and it's first and 10 at the DSU 32. Rankin under center, Randolph behind him. It'll be Jalen with the carry, looking for some space, has some to the 22-yard line, and another first down as he gets to the 20. A couple yards after contact for Jalen Randolph, and back in the red zone go the Hens. Tackle that time made by Logan Westcott from Woodbridge High School in Delaware.
Some of these runs, until you get 10 yards down the field, don't they look like scrimmages where you're not live, you're not tackling, just the way these guys are running upright into the secondary? Delaware State, they might have to go back and do some more tackling drills.
Coming out of the huddle, we see Chichi Amachi from William Penn. He's the only true freshman listed anywhere on the two deep for Delaware. Second time we see him. Also Riley Angeline in the game. Randolph stops on a dime, cuts it back in, turns nothing into something as he gets to the 13-yard line.
Well, that's the balance that Dave Brock has been able to create, and they took some licks early because of it, but redshirting guys strategically to get extra fifth years inside the program. They only had 7 or 8 freshmen come in this season, so there's not that many true freshmen available to play. Took a couple of transfers, but it was a very small recruiting class because he's built more of that roster balance, and that's a really good sign because that means you end up with those 21, 22, 23-year-olds on your roster.
I form under a minute in the third, second and 3 from the 13 of Dell State, and they'll go to Thomas Jefferson, who gets tackled by Barnes as he makes his way to the 10-yard line. Should be enough to make it first and goal to go for the Hens.
We weren't making excuses in years past. When you're 18, 19, you weigh 235, 240, and you're trying to go head-to-head against a guy who is faster than you and weighs the exact same, you're just not going to win a lot of those matchups. But now all of a sudden, those guys that were 235, 240, they're solid 235, 240, or they're up to 250, 255. And now you got that size advantage if you're UD in a lot of different positions.
I form on first and goal from the 10. Rankin under center. And he'll roll out. Pressure coming towards the sideline. Throwing on the run. Back of the end zone. Up for grabs and caught. A touchdown for Delaware. Another amazing play. Tiptoeing the sideline. And the Hens go up 48-7. It was Charles Scarf, the transfer from Rutgers,
stick around for a while, Scarf. That's phenomenal because he runs the back line of the end zone with Rankin as Rankin rolls out almost like one of those old-fashioned sprint right options they used to run all the time in the West Coast offense. He's got the receiver coming across the back line. Rankin throws it where only Scarf's got a chance or it's an incompletion. It's a perfect throw from Rankin even though it's up high. And then Scarf, strong hands to bring that down and then the body control to make sure he got a foot in.
Charles Scarf.
The ruling on the field was a completed catch for a touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
Okay. Take a look at it because they can.
I've had enough of replay now. Let's save it for
he got it
big situations, not in 41-point games at the end of the third quarter.
Charles Scarf, the transfer from Rutgers, had 14 catches, 100 yards, and a touchdown a season ago. He scored his touchdown last year on a one-yard catch versus Maryland back in November. And I don't know if they'll show it on the big board here at Delaware Stadium, but from first look, first glance up here, it looked like he got it.
They do put it up on the board while you watch that. We'll talk about Scarf. He's a guy who can play tight end and slot. They worked with him in the slot for the beginning portion of camp. That's really close. Because the front of that foot came down. Was the heel on the line or did he keep it up in the air? It's about as close as they come.
It was the back of the end zone. Did he bobble it? Could also be a question as he really took it up and over the defender. He got both feet down. As a matter of, you're right, did the heel touch the back line anywhere? A couple of angles here. Great job by the video crew.
Yeah, I think that's a touchdown. You only have to get one down in the college game. He kept that toe down and kept the heel up, and then the other foot comes down with the toe same way, and then contact comes from the defender. Really close, but called a touchdown on the field. I think he had to stay.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown.
There it is. Not confirmed, but stands. Not enough evidence to overturn. And you get to celebrate all over again. Replay's not that bad.
That was the final play of the third. 48-7 is the score as Rango on for what's been a busy day for him.
What a throw by Blake Rankin, though. Yeah. Off his back foot, running out of bounds. That's the only spot where he could put that football. He couldn't have put it any better.
Holder is Stevenson. We've seen this before. Rango up. And through. Your PNC Bank timeout score. Delaware 49, Delaware State 7 at the end of the third. Fourth quarter action coming up on 94.7 WDSD.
Capriati said. Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any two. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
Just tuning in or want to watch this or any Hens All Access broadcast from the start? Visit our YouTube channel at youtube.com/UDBlueHens.
This is Blue Hens Country, 94.7 WDSD.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium where the Hens go 5 plays, 48 yards, and it ends on a Blake Rankin toss to Charles Scarf. 49-7 is the count. It looks like it's a whole lot of fun on the sideline. Mike, you having as much fun as we are up here?
Guys, it's a party here on the sideline. They know by now this game is over. They're getting the reserves into the game. It's great to see this kind of play from Delaware. Last year, that play action that we scored on, is not something we had in our offense. We didn't have the confidence to throw the ball. We didn't have the big receivers who we knew could catch the ball on the offensive side. So it's great to see new things from this 2016 Blue Hen offense.
I agree with you there. 49 points, that's something new in a ball game for Delaware, a team that averaged just under 15 points per game a season ago, 107th of 123 FCS teams in 2015. Unbelievable start to this season. Let's look at some individual stats as Walker, 6 of 9, 66 yards and a touchdown. Rankin, perfect, 2 of 2, 26 yards and a score. Rushing the football, Wes Hills. Welcome back. Get ready to inscribe that his name on the Nate Beasley MVP award. 19 carries, 212 yards and 2 touchdowns, along of 59. Thomas Jefferson, 13 carries, 70 yards. 11 carries for Jalen Randolph, 55 yards and 2 touchdowns. Walker on the ground, 6 rushing attempts and 39 yards and a touchdown. Deontay Cherry's caught 2 for a score. Scarf has caught 2 for a score as well. Defensively, Reeder with 4. The stats, nothing to blow you away because the defense has not been on the field very long. Just 13 minutes of action for the DSU offense. But Reeder leads with 4. Bell with 3. Guachabano has 2. Maurice Harley with a fumble recovery. Armin Ware has 2 sacks. Cam Kitchen has 1. And 2 INTs from Anthony Jackson.
Those are the stats that blow you away. The 4 takeaways by the Delaware defense at 28 yards rushing. That's all they've allowed. The strength of Delaware State's offense is supposed to be running the football. Now, they're a 1-10 football team with 42 new bodies, so they're not a lot of big strengths, but that's what it is.
A line will take it right side of the field, running all the way to left at the 10, and he cannot outrun Casey Hinton. Justin Watson lowers the boom as a line just runs out of real estate. A flag thrown late. That's Watson again. That's the third big penalty against the junior.
That's not going to make Dave Brock happy. And as a matter of fact, he is red-faced over on the Blue Hens sideline. Somebody's going to hear about that one. Boy. You just don't need to say anything in that spot. You made the great hit. Just walk away. And that's what Dave Brock teaches his team to do all the time.
Watson fired up, the redshirt junior from Friendship Academy. Great season a year ago. 45 tackles, 8 pass breakups, led the team in that category. He's got 12 career pass breakups he's played since being a freshman.
After the play, dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 6 of the receiving team. Half the distance to the goal, receiving team keeps the ball, first down.
Well, there you
that
go.
That is number 6, first unsportsmanlike conduct foul of Delaware State.
They got the retaliation, and, you know, I think that's fine that they call it that way, but they've tried to, one of the points of emphasis this year is to try to take away the offsetting penalties, but we saw Tate Brock's reaction. He was pink. He went out to the hash marks to go yell at his football team, and the officials still call it against Delaware State. That's when you know it's not your night.
A lot of frustrations adding up for Delaware State. They'll start 1st and 10 from their own 6-yard line. Intercepted by Troy Reeder. Welcome back to Delaware. Pick 6. What a play by the transfer from Penn State, Delaware's own Troy Reeder. And the score is 55-7.
Just a great read by Reeder. He has all kinds of speed on a beeline to that football. Caught it in stride as he was breaking at the ball and got the turnover easy. Jog into the end zone. He just made that look too simple. This kid is electric.
4 tackles, a half sack, get an INT for a score. 14-48 remaining in the fourth, and the Hens put up numbers. The 5th takeaway by the defense that time for 6. Frank Rago on for the extra point. And he boots that one through. We're going to keep it right here because I want to talk a little bit more about Troy Reeder with Michael Atanarase, who knows Troy very well. You know, he was having a good freshman season a year ago, and Michael and Troy were texting before a big day that he had as a Nittany Lion. Mike, tell that story.
Well, the first game of the season last year was against Temple, and Troy did not start, but ended up playing a little bit late in that game because of an injury. And he was set to start the next week against Buffalo. So a lot of people were congratulating him. Hey, congratulations on starting. I sent him a text that morning. I said, Troy, you're starting material. No congratulations for starting. I'll congratulate you after a double-digit tackle game. He texted me after that Buffalo game. He had 13, his first game starting as a Nittany Lion. That's the kind of player he is. That's a special talent, and you just see him show that on the field.
I remember the pride by Mike after receiving that back and forth from Troy. He showed me before the game, hey, I challenged him, get double-digit tackles, and then after the game, he ran back up in the booth, showed me the stat line of Troy Reader, and now those stats are for the right team, blue and gold. A pick six, it's 56-7. Delaware on top. There's still 14:48 left to play at Delaware Stadium.
Those kind of plays run in the veins, don't they? I mean, his brother Colby's going to be a big-time player with Delaware, and his dad Dan was a phenomenal player back in the Tubby Raymond days.
Kickoff and a line back in. He'll run up for it at the 9-yard line, 15-20. 25 and contact made. Charles Bell with his fourth tackle.
I'm sure a lot of people that are still tuning in at this point with heads up 49 in the fourth quarter. We're following closely to that 100 plays and 100 days that they had out on social media all offseason long. And it was really fun going through some of the memories, the Youngstown State game from the 70s.
Number 7 of the kicking team. 5-yard penalty, re-kick.
Trey Jones is firing up.
Unforced air that'll make Dave Brock, or at least give him a teaching point when they watch the film. But Dan Reeder was prominently featured in a couple of touchdown passes that he caught at the old Vet when Delaware beat Temple back in the 80s.
Yeah, when you talk about Troy Reeder, as far as name recognition in the state, after the career he had at Salesiana and a big-time player that could go to a big-time program, certainly not to the level where he's the greatest player on earth like Elena Deledon is, but name recognition-wise, to get a player that's that talented from the state of Delaware to transfer back home and play for the hometown Hens, it's in that ballpark as how big it was for Delaware to get Colby first, who turned down offers from Miami, looks from Clemson, Connecticut, to come, and then Troy Reeder to follow.
Well, it wasn't a transfer of I'm not going to play at Penn State, yep, or I'm unhappy. It was I want to come back to Delaware, and that's good because obviously you'd like the kid to be happy, but it's also good because he was going to play a lot this year at Penn State. He probably was going to be a starter at linebacker. He was going to be a big part of James Franklin's defense, and to have a Big Ten caliber player start as your linebacker when you were already really deep at that position, I mean, you can figure it out for yourself what that means for Dave Brock's club.
They move the football back 5 yards, re-kick it, and a line going to take it from the 6-yard line, 10, 15, 20, down the sideline at the 30, has some blocking at the 40, cuts it up at the 50, into Delaware territory at the 44-yard line. He was tracked down from behind by Eric Patton, who is a great special teams player himself. Bryson Aline has been the high point on special teams tonight for Delaware State. Two big returns. His first one was of 46 yards, and that one was 50 by Aline.
I just lost the edge that time. On the outside, I think it was Kyle Yoakum on the edge. Number 10, hard to tell the zeros and the eights here on these Delaware uniforms. I think it was Kyle Yoakum, and that opened up the seam.
Mike Waters is hit as he gets the 40-yard line. They're high on Waters from Hotopen Charter, led the team to a 15-0 record last year as a high school senior. And like you said earlier, 14-19 and ticking in the fourth. Now if you're Del State, you're working on some things.
It's like a preseason game at this point. You flush the result down the toilet.
Epperson throwing screen to his favorite target, Rutherford. First down a little bit more as he gets to the 30, far side of the field. And the tackle made by Mark Doe, who's in the game for the first series.
This indicates how much depth Delaware has defensively, though, because look at the bodies that are out here. You're into the quote-unquote second-teamers, but you got a lot of big names still out on the field. I mean, a Guachavano, a Hinton, and Anthony Jackson still out there. A lot of guys that are in your regular rotation because that's just your two deep. That's how it works.
Kindle's on the field. He started last season at the linebacker position. As the Hornets go trips to the right side. One back, Mike Waters. First and 10 at the Delaware 29. 13:40 left. Screen pass is bobbled but caught. And Anthony Jackson there again. He's got two INTs out of tackle for loss to his stat line. He was all over it.
Mason Rutherford caught a touchdown pass earlier, but he got eaten up on that play. Just a fantastic effort. How many times have we talked about Jackson shedding a block and making something happen in space? That time was completely engaged by the wide receiver. That should have gone for 10 yards, and Jackson turns it into a loss.
It's second down and 13 from the Hens 32 after a 50-yard return by Bryson Aline. Sets Delaware State up to start this drive in Hens territory. Epperson looking, tossing in the backfield for Waters. Room to run to the 25-24 as Jalen Kindle makes the stop. 24-yard line, and it'll be third down.
Now, Del State in this second half, their real concentration has been to try to create space and get the ball, either dumping it down to their backs or their wide receivers on the edge. And they have found a little bit of success with that.
Trips to the far side for Epperson on third down and five. Epperson throwing on the slant, and it's caught by Harris Scott for a first down. 46 catches a season ago for the senior. Scott, a lot of potential for him, but he's had some trouble with five different quarterbacks over his career. And now in his senior campaign, last chance to put up all conference numbers, but he has the potential. It's first and 10 from the Delaware, 13 in the red zone. For the second time today is DSU. Trips to the left side, Rutherford to the right. Waters is the back. Epperson going to throw again. Has time again. End zone this time. Overthrows his target, Aris Scott. Good coverage that time from Simba Guashavana.
You know, Scott's supposed to be a big play guy. He had 9 catches, 20 yards or more last season. And he's been very quiet down the field tonight. Delaware, the safeties are so quick. It's hard to hit the big plays. They had the one up the seam, and that's just about it. And also, I mean, the accuracy of the quarterback and the lack of arm strength, I think, has hurt them a little bit this evening as well.
Epperson, 11 of 20, 101 yards, 4 interceptions. He's in shotgun on second and 10 from the Delaware 13. Epperson, pressure coming. He gets away from it, looking for somewhere to run. Throws it towards the end zone. Gets rid of it before he was dragged down. A lot of defenders were in the mix. Kitchen was there. We saw Ware bringing the heat. And also Aaron Donaldson. Think, off of the edge.
I think that's going to make Kenny Carter happy, though, Scott, because that's really the first time he's thrown the football away all night. He talked about the 4 interceptions. He just made some decisions that kind of make you scratch your head. He has some athleticism. He can break contain. He throws the ball okay on the run. He's not all that accurate from inside the pocket, but he's got to learn to throw the football away like he did on that last step.
Delaware up 56-7. 11:56 remaining. And a timeout's going to be taken by Delaware. And while they talk
timeout,
things over,
Delaware State, their first charge timeout of the half.
We're going to stay right here. I want to remind our listeners that a portion of this broadcast is brought to you by Concord Pet Foods and Supplies, founded by Larry Mutchler. His brother, Woody Mutchler, is a 40-year season ticket holder to UAD football games. He never missed a Saturday in Newark and frequently traveled to away games as well. Woody passed away earlier this year after a battle with brain cancer. He looked forward to every fall and cheering on the Fighting Blue Hens. The Mutchler family still holds season tickets and will be here every Saturday this season doing what Woody would have wanted, spending time with his family and cheering on the team that he loved so much. Today, we remember Woody Mutchler, and our thoughts are with the Mutchler family. A great family and big Blue Hen supporters, so we wanted to say our thoughts are with you. 11:56 remaining in this ballgame. Let's take a look at some scores from around college football.
Well, the one that we're watching is that App State-Tennessee game, and App State still leading 13-3, starting to get deep into the third quarter of that game. Now 5 minutes and 45 seconds to go. That game is at Neyland Stadium in Tennessee. Oh, man, I wouldn't want to be Butch Jones if the Volunteers don't come back and try to win that game. They have high aspirations this season, a preseason top 10 team. Earlier, we were looking at that UConn and Maine game, as Maine has been really giving UConn all they could handle. That was a tie game late in the third quarter. Well, Maine has taken the lead, 9:56 to go with the fourth. Black Bears up 21-14. How monumental a win would that be for the CAA? A little bit of a step back for the conference in the next score. North Dakota now leading Stony Brook 9-7. That game is in the fourth quarter being played at Long Island. And William & Mary holding its own. Down 2 touchdowns to NC State. 10:38 to go in the third quarter down in Raleigh.
After the timeout by Del State, team back on the field. Third down and 10. Ball at the 13 of Delaware. And the Red Hat still on the field. Couple people talking things over with the ref. This one not televised, but still media timeout. And now we're ready to play.
We got to pay our bills too, Scott.
That's right. Kenny Carter called his first timeout from the sideline before third down and 10. Down 56-7 are the Hornets. Epperson throwing, catching is a line, running towards the end zone, and he got in. Bryson Alon. He's had a great night on special teams, and now he has a touchdown to add to his total. It's 56-13 Hens.
They got the linebacker isolated on the back, and it just too long for Spears to have to cover as he had time. They go across from the near side of the formation all the way to the far sideline. Spears did all he could, but lost the angle. Then he tried to go get him at the pylon, just could not drag him down in time. And that's just not the matchup you want. Spears is a really good player, but Alain is quick.
Extra point is up and through. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 56, DSU 14, 11, 49 to play here at Delaware Stadium. They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
WDSD and iHeartRadio.
As you come to play here in the second half of football, still down 56-14, but two touchdowns in the second half. Eight plays, 44 yards on that drive. Ended with a Daniel Epperson pass for a touchdown to sophomore Bryson Alon of 13 yards. And now the squib on the kickoff. Upman will take it at the 25-30. It's Yoakum had a couple of those last season, and now down at the 40-yard line is Kyle Yoakum. Earlier this week, UD Director of Multimedia Jimmy Smith announced that he'll be leaving the university after over 5 years of hard work and dedication to the Hens. The Ohio native will be going home as the new manager of social media and communications for Fox Sports Ohio. Make no mistake, though, Jimmy made Delaware his home since 2011 and bled blue and gold. Jimmy's talent, vision, and innovation moved Delaware light years ahead and made Blue Hens content one of the best in the nation at any level. From someone that has personally benefited from his talent and friendship, Jimmy, you're going to be missed. As much as your talent has helped me through the years, your friendship has helped so much more. Best wishes to you, your wife, Shanna, and your beautiful baby daughter, Lila, as you continue your lives back home in Ohio. Fox Sports Ohio is very lucky to be getting Jimmy Smith, and we are all in debt for the great job you have done over the years. Thank you, Jimmy. This drive starts first and 10 from the Delaware 40-yard line. 11:25 left to play. And Delaware up 56-14. A great way to start the season.
Fantastic show. I just want to echo your sentiments. We'll miss Jimmy Smith for sure. Fantastic work, fantastic guy. Fantastic night for Delaware, though, here. I mean, to put 56 on the board and to do it in as many different ways as they have. Turnovers, a couple of passing touchdowns, just a clinic on the ground.
Chi-Chi in, Emerson in, Eric Patton getting the carry. And he'll take it to the 48-yard line. Eric Patton a season ago had one carry. He was more of a blocking back, still is. Gets the job done on special teams. He recovered a fumble last year in that win over New Hampshire. And now getting some action on the offense.
You know what time it is, Scott? Pop quiz time for the play-by-play announcer. How deep to the chart? How much homework did you do coming into the game as we go deep into the depth chart?
I had Patton listed. What do you want to know? Actually, good story on Eric Patton. Andre, his brother, was recruited by Dave Brock to go to Rutgers. He said he met Eric while he was recruiting Andre, and now Eric is in his backfield right now on third down and two from the Delaware 48-yard line. And Patton hit hard but stays on his feet trying to break away. He'll lose a couple, but he absorbed the impact on that first hit. Delaware going to have to punt the football, a three and out late in this ball game, under 10 and ticking to go. Delaware up 56-14 now.
For Patton, I mean, just untouched, the linebacker filling the gap, got low on him. Incredible that he stayed on his feet, and he tried to bounce it to the outside because that was one heck of a hit that he took and tried to get wide on. Couldn't quite do it, but you get an A-minus for that first quiz, though. That's a pretty good story.
I try. We'll see as we get to the five-minute mark how well I do. Stevenson, he's new. The punter transfer from NC State gets this one away and rocked. Loose comes the football at the 24-yard line. I believe Delaware has the football. I started to break my eyes away because I assumed a fair catch was called. There was no single signal of fair catch. And the DSU punt returner was leveled.
And he's still down, and the concern is there. The officials aren't quite sure whose football that is. But in a 56-14 game, with the kind of collision we just witnessed, the concern is with the young man who's down. And that was just a huge hit. The question is, do they call targeting? Because remember, the targeting rule is still in effect, and you would lose whoever made the hit in the first half of next week. I thought it was a clean shoulder shot, but the officials discussing it. Kenny Carter came over and certainly gave his opinion that he thought the lead was with the crown of the helmet. I thought it was a shoulder shot.
As did I. It seemed like a clean, at least on, and it happened very fast. On first sight, just a hard hit from a guy that should have called a fair catch with defenders.
I think it's Mason Rutherford.
Rutherford is a transfer from San Bernardino Valley College. It is Rutherford as he pops up. We haven't seen a replay. I believe it was Adderley. And again, I kind of...
Ruling on the field was a muffed kick recovered by the kicking team.
Was recovered by Delaware State. Was recovered by Delaware State.
No, recovered by the kicking team. Delaware.
Oh, excuse me, by Delaware. I'm still in shock on the
hit.
Pop I just
yeah.
saw.
You gotta call fair catch in that situation. We have seen guys almost reluctant to call fair catch over the course of this game. Kenny Carter was really upset with the official. He thought it was a helmet-to-helmet shot. Again, we never saw the replay, but it looked at the naked eye, and it's hard to see at the naked eye because it happened at the blink of an eye, but it looked like it was a clean shoulder shot.
Delaware, another takeaway, and they've got the football to start in DSU territory. First and 10 on the 24 of 56-14. I form, it'll be Patton again, and he's tackled for another loss. This time a loss of three, maybe four. Cartier Wilkins with the tackle.
I think if you're the Delaware State staff, as they put it up on the board now, it was close. Well, that last hit, it was not an intentional lead with the head, but it might have been one of those incidental things where the helmets did strike each other because of the angle of the hit. And that's one of the things I don't like about the targeting rule, because they don't give you a lot of leeway for interpretation of whether it was an intentional crown of the helmet shot. It's just, where did the contact come from?
It was Adderley on the hit. It was flying down.
That would have been a costly loss if he had gotten a targeting penalty.
Patton with some room this time. Gets 4 yards to the 25 before he's brought down. Rankin is the quarterback. Day is done for Joe Walker, who finishes 6 of 9 for 66 yards. 6 carries, 39, and a touchdown. He had some pinpoint accuracy on a toss to Jamie Jarman that was dropped, and a beautiful throw for a touchdown to Deontay Cherry. Blake Rankin has come in since. We'll see Delaware run the football a bunch up big here in the fourth, but Rankin 2 of 2 and a touchdown himself. 26 yards in the air and a 13-yard touchdown pass to Charles Scarf, the newest member of Delaware. Third and 11 for the Hens on Del State's 25-yard line. Blitz coming, and flags are thrown.
That was off from the start. They weren't lined up
Ball
properly.
Start, number 74 offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
So they sent the receiver late in motion that time. Chi-Chi came tight to the line of scrimmage. That didn't give Rankin a chance to vary the snap count, and they had the blitz timed up perfectly. Delaware trying to react to it, and the flinch as they got Steve Robinson for the false start.
Reserves in on the line as well for Delaware. Steve Robinson, the redshirt freshman from Philly, taking the spot of Will Lewis on the offensive line. We also see DeAndre Davis come in for the first time. He played a bit last year at wide receiver, St. Mark's graduate. Third and 16 for Delaware. And Patton with the carry again. He's rumbling, and he can't get past a defender at the 25. Who kind of grabbed him by the leg, and that was Jahad Niebauer, who we've called the name of a couple times this evening. 7-16 and ticking in the fourth.
Get a field goal try here for Frank Rago, who certainly has not been cheated if it was a fantasy football game with his 8 extra points. A chance to kick one here. He was in a competition during summer camp. I think more of a competition than Dave Brock was anticipating, because the kickoff from Jake Roth were so impressive.
This one's 41 yards for Frank Rago. He made 44 and 45 a season ago. He made 10 field goals last season, a freshman record at Delaware. Big game winner against William Mary, you remember. And that kick has the distance, but is wide to the left. I don't know if Stevenson got the hold spun around, but no points for Delaware. Still up 56 to 14, and we'll take a timeout. That's our PNC Bank timeout score with 6:35 remaining in quarter number four.
Welcome. How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
And a goal! It's Delgado with his second.
Some reserves in the game. They miss a 41-yard attempt from Frank Rago, his first try on the season. He was 10 of 16 a season ago, and he missed wide to the left. It remains 56-14, the lead for the Hens. Mike on the sideline, what do you see on that field goal try?
Yeah, I wouldn't blame that all on Frank Rago. The kick was wide left, but the snap skipped across the turf. Sheridan's snap was low, which made it hard for Stevenson to get it down. So Rago, last second, had to delay the swing of his leg, and I think that's what caused the missed field goal.
New snapper this year is Tim Sheridan. Joe Fortunato didn't call his name a lot, and it's because he did such a good job for 4 years. You don't call the snapper's name much unless something goes wrong. And Tim Sheridan, now the long snapper after a great career by Joe. Missed field goal by the Hens gives Del State the football back at their own 24-yard line, and some pressure coming on the run by a line. Marvin Ware was there first. DSU played better in the second half, but just way too big a deficit to overcome. Delaware, 477 total yards of offense. A line running into a Delaware defender, finishing on the tackle was Tommy Wilmoth. And also Aaron Donaldson is there.
It'll be interesting to see how much Delaware utilizes the Wildcat over the course of the season. Was this something you wanted to put on the field? You knew you had an advantage over Delaware State, and now you want to make teams prepare for it. Is this going to be a big focal point of the offense as the year progresses? Because it certainly was incredibly successful tonight with both Hills and Jefferson ran it, especially Hills with his pure athleticism.
And he went 59 yards, made the crowd forget very quickly about that drop pass that happened just moments prior to it. Here comes Donaldson, pressure on Epperson, and that one falls incomplete. Donaldson pressured the throw, and Maurice Harley, who already has a fumble recovery, almost got himself an INT there, went through his hands a bit hot.
By the way, one other score, a team that Delaware will play in a few weeks, Wake Forest. Talk about Wake Forest all these years. Dave Clawson, their head coach, supposed to be an offensive genius. They've never gotten the offense going down there. It's 7-3. 2 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. Tulane driving in that game. So it looks like Wake's still having its issues offensively against a Delaware defense that certainly is capable. Perhaps that'll be an interesting game in a few weeks down in Winston-Salem.
Vinny Papali will be back to return this punt on 4th and 12 by DSU. Papali running for it as it bounces at the 45. Has some room to pick it up at the 40. Sutter step at the 45. That's where it bounced. Polly with the first return of the day for Delaware Bluehead. 42 yards on the punt. Delaware offense will come back out. 5:16 to go. And the Hens up 56-14. An outstanding start to this Delaware football season. I don't remember a season, at least in recent years, with this much anticipation, this much exciting and good emotions towards the football team, and they did not disappoint.
I think it was Brock's first year. You really have to go back to look at the excitement around, and Delaware won the opener against Jacksonville, but gave up a ton of points. It kind of set the omen for the rest of the season.
Patton will get another carry. He's having a tough time as there's some offensive linemen that are reserves blocking for him, and he gets tackled for a big loss back to the 40. Minus five on that run. Patton, 6 carries, 4 yards now.
Pat's probably sitting around wondering, I watched the first 3 quarters of this game. Nobody got touched within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage. I can't even get back to the line of scrimmage before I'm having to stop, change direction. But Del State still got its starters, and Delaware going to the second and third stringers at this point.
Patton, 1,348 yards rushing as a senior at Saney, 16 touchdowns. So he's had the football in his hands before, that's for sure. Known for his defense in high school, 2-time state player of the year. And now a fullback for this Delaware team. Second and 15, ball on the 40 in Delaware territory. Rankin's the quarterback, Patton the running back to the right side, and he's hit by Ted Noble at the 43-yard line. Noble, a starter, you're right, Matt. Starter still in for DSU. 14 tackles for Logan Westcott. He leads the team in that category. Malik Harris, who is our UD Star Health Star Watch player, has 9 tackles. The tackle stat's not high on the other side for Delaware, as Reeder leads everybody with 4, but so many other categories have been filled in.
Well, it's balance, too. It's everybody getting involved, and that's the Dave Brock blueprint. That's what he's been trying to build over these last several years, so that you can come at them in waves, always fresh bodies, and, you know, just a guy who can play 2 or 3 snaps and then get subbed out and have somebody else pop in.
Third down and 12, it's Patton again, Hens just working some clock down as he gets to the 47-yard line, and we'll see Stevenson again to punt things away.
But I do agree with you in terms of the excitement surrounding this program, all the optimism coming in. And I certainly lived up to it. And we told you the stat earlier that in his first 3 opening day games, he had been outscored, Dave Brock had 42-0 in the first quarter. So to pop 14 on the board quickly against Delaware State, completely flip that script, be up 28-0 at the half, and just play an incredibly consistent first 3 quarters. I mean, it just sets the tone. And I just wish there was another home game waiting in the wings. It's a while till you get to build upon this, at least here at Delaware Stadium.
Yeah, how about Delaware's schedule? As Stevenson gets a boomer high, and Aris Scott, he's no fool. Fair catch. Matt just mentioned it. Delaware State tonight, and then at Lafayette, at Wake Forest, a bye week, at James Madison, and then Parents Weekend comes October 8th against Maine. So if anything, you at least gave the fans something to come back and want to see, because this was exciting football tonight.
And it would really help if you could get back home at 3-1. I mean, that is certainly a torturous stretch, a rare 3-game road trip. You just don't see those very often. It's the longest stretch Delaware has gone without a home game in more than 20 years.
Epperson going to throw, high caught, 15-yard line, and brought down by Harley. And number 37 doesn't have a name on the roster, but he was there as well.
25 years, in fact, the last time Delaware went 5 weeks between home games, 1991.
Yeah, a lot of rarities on the schedule this season, that's for sure. Epperson, here comes Donaldson, and Epperson tosses it away just in time. I've been very impressed with Aaron Donaldson, the transfer. He played at Dean Junior College a season ago when he had 5 sacks and redshirted as a freshman at Coastal Carolina, but Coach Brock was right when he told us about his speed.
Donaldson off the edge. Robin Ware played a very good game. Nassib with his typical disruptive nature in the middle. Cam Kitchen, I thought, was very productive in stretches. It is a deep defensive line, and you don't need one guy to dominate. You just need everybody to step up and do their job, and then Donaldson's going to be that third down specialist.
Epperson on 3rd and 6, 2:29 to play. Overthrows the screen pass to Waters. That's the kind of night it's been for DSU. 4th down and 6. Delaware will get the football back at least one more time. 2:25 to go. After this game, they'll announce the Nate Beasley MVP award. Last time these two teams met in 2014, the game was on a Sunday, and Jalen Randolph took home the trophy. My vote goes to West Hills.
Yeah, I think it's
unless the defense can collect it all together.
A unanimous award, although Anthony Jackson made a run at it, certainly with his performance defensively. But yeah, I think it's got to go to Hills at 219.
Punt unit out for DSU. Light pressure from Hinton getting it away, and Papali back to return again. Foot at the 41-yard line. Breaks one tackler, can't break another. And Teron Selby made the stop. 38-yard punt for DSU in the hands. We'll get the football with 2:15 remaining in the fourth quarter. 56 points on the board after an offense that really struggled a season ago. They came out with some firepower, helped by a pick six from Troy Reeder, helped from five takeaways by the defense when you talk field position. But it's been a great night for the Hens against their in-state rival, Delaware State. And the Hens moved to 7-0 against DSU all time.
They got the Prez up on the video board.
They like to see this. New president for Delaware. New athletic director, smiles on both of their faces as well. Chrissy Raywalk has been very impressive in her short time in control of Delaware.
The North Dakota State Series.
Yeah, wow.
Great I know job. That got everybody hyped up.
That was exciting. Some movement on the defensive front. No flag, though, before the snap. And Patton still working hard. He's grinding, churning upfield. He gets to the 48-yard line, a pickup of two on first down as the clock getting near 2 minutes.
Just nice to have this game unfold without something weird happening from Mother Nature. The last two times these teams squared off, I mean, remember we got evacuated in both of those games from this press box.
That's right.
It never had happened before, and it happened two times in a row against Delaware State. We got the long delay in the game in 2011, and then a couple of years ago, we just flat out got it postponed until Sunday. We're playing opposite of NFL opening day.
But the result, again, a win for Delaware. And this one in dominating fashion. The most points Delaware has scored against Delaware State. It one-ups as Patton gets the football again on second down and 8. Gets 6 yards on that carry. It ups the point total in 2011 when it was 45-0. And, of course, that first playoff game back in 2007 when it was 44-7. Interesting enough, Delaware State not going to be a playoff team no matter how well they do this year. It's the MEAC and the SWAC will play in their own HBCU championship game in Atlanta. So this is the only chance Delaware has to play. And pretty fair to say no matter what, even if they were allowed to be in the playoffs, it's a rebuilding year still for DSU after tonight.
But I like what Kenny Carter's doing long term. I do think he has the right plan in place to have success there eventually.
Pitch goes to Patton, and he picks up maybe a yard on third down and 3. 37 seconds remaining. Looks like a player's down. Don't want that on what should have been the final play of the game. Clock stopped at 33 seconds. Might be, I don't want to guess. There's a 6 on the jersey. I don't want to guess right now.
Thistle.
Yeah, Peter Thistle, the center. Redshirt junior Mario Farinella. Injured. Bilal Nichols was injured earlier, and if you were to take away any negative in this game, it was the fact that in a blowout victory, and those injuries came early. They came in early in the first half. Unfortunately, a couple of major contributors for this team had to leave early with injuries. Thistle is sitting up.
The game clock has been stopped due to an injury to an offensive player inside 1 minute remaining in the half. The defense will decline the 10-second runoff, and the game clock will start on the snap.
Thistle gets up. And even though Delaware wins 56-14, or will win 56-14, they'll have some healing to do before heading on the road to the Patriot League foe Lafayette next week.
That's an interesting game for Delaware because Lafayette's supposed to be better than they were a season ago. Delaware, who really struggled, was able to take care of business against the Leopards. They beat them in that bounce-back game after dropping the opener to Jacksonville. But it's a different animal when you play on the road. And while it's a more experienced team, certainly, than last season, it's still young across the board. It's still first road game of the season. You never quite know how you're going to react. They don't tend to draw huge crowds in Lafayette, so it might be kind of a weird atmosphere as a Saturday evening game. And the good news is you get an extra couple of days because this one's played on a Thursday to heal. You get the opportunity to see Lafayette on Saturday. So there are some positives to it, but I mean, going on the road to play a Patriot League team is probably not exactly what Dave Brock had in mind.
33 seconds left in this one, I will say. A lot goes into the first game of the season. I think there's a lot of UD staff members that'll be sleeping over Labor Day weekend. A lot of hard work makes this happen, especially at the radio station as well. It's all forgotten once things kick off. I love calling games with you, Matt. I'm looking forward to another great year.
Great to be back, and great to see this type of action. And how about Mike just prowling the sidelines all night long?
Yeah, love
all over
with
the place.
Love working with this team. Mike Diodati on the dish. James Taylor producing. Tyler Fitzpatrick is with us this season as well. Excited to have him on board.
Mike Diodati's down there playing with pain. He's got his knee all wrapped up. Still running all over the sideline.
Getting us that great sound on the sideline. Stevenson punts it away with no one back to return on fourth and two, and it'll roll into the end zone.
Oh, you know that just crushed him a little bit inside. The stats just went by the wayside. He was trying to get a cheap inside the 10 on his putting line, as he's had a heck of a day. That's one area where you maybe weren't sure. Dave Brock seemed very certain, but we hadn't seen him punt yet. Feel pretty good about that. You miss Eric Anderson because he was fantastic. He was a leader in the special teams room, and he was so consistent. It was one game, but it was a good game from Will Stevenson tonight.
Stevenson, a graduate student. This is his first game. I mean, he didn't play at NC State. Grad student out of Raleigh, North Carolina, and he's looked good. You're right. A lot going on post-game as Delaware going to win this one 56-14 unless DSU tries to get fancy with 24 seconds left. We'll have, of course, the team will sing the fight song. We'll have the presentation of the Nate Beasley MVP Award. Michael Attanasio will have the post-game interview. We'll have highlights from this one, and boy, there was a lot of them tonight. Epperson will hand the football off to his running back, and that should be the final play as Sika Bendoff, a Delaware native, gets out to the 24. 15, 14 seconds.
1-0 is better than 0-1, right?
Absolutely. The Hens, as DSU stayed on the field with 3 seconds left. Clock now shows 0 in Delaware. Improves to 7-0 all time against their in-state rival, Delaware State. An impressive 56-14 victory over the Hornets in the season opener. Coaches shake hands, and again, a lot of stuff going on post-game. As we'll see the presentation, Christy Raywalk will be out there, the new athletic director, to get her first presentation of the trophy. All thoughts here. I think it'll be a no-brainer as far as who will win the MVP trophy in West Hills. But it was everything we wanted and more from the Hens on opening night.